delegates are kindly requested to take their seats. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, the fourth meeting of the General Assembly is called to order. Before proceeding further, I would like to remind members that masks are to be worn by the attendees at all times when indoors, except when directly addressing the meeting. Due to the temporary closure of the east side emergency doors, in the event of fire or an emergency which requires an evacuation, please use the west side emergency doors and the stairway next to the elevator banks. Those in the third and fourth balconies, please use the stairway next to the elevator banks. Before proceeding to the general debate, as announced in the journal, the General Assembly will hear an introduction by the Secretary General of his annual report on the work of the organization under agenda item 113, in accordance with the resolution 51/241 and notwithstanding of provisions in decision 77/504. We shall proceed accordingly. Now I give the floor to the Secretary General of the United Nations, His Excellency Mr. Antonio Guterres.
Mr. President of the General Assembly, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, our world is in big trouble. Divides are growing deeper, inequalities are growing wider, and challenges are spreading farther. But as we come together in a world teeming with turmoil, an image of promise and hope comes to my mind. This ship is the brave commander. It sailed the Black Sea with UN flag flying high and proud. On one hand, what you see is a vessel like any other plying the seas. But look closer. At its essence, this ship is a symbol of what we can accomplish when we act together. It is loaded with Ukrainian grain destined for the people of the Horn of Africa, millions of whom are on the edge of famine. It navigated through a war zone, guided by the very parties to the conflict, as part of an unprecedented comprehensive initiative to get more food and fertilizer out of Ukraine and Russia, to bring desperately needed relief to those in need, to calm commodity markets, secure future harvests, and lower prices for consumers everywhere. Ukraine and the Russian Federation, with the support of Turkey, came together to make it happen, despite the enormous complexities, the naysayers, and even the hell of war. Some might call it a miracle on the sea. In truth, it is multilateral diplomacy in action. The Black Sea Grain Initiative has opened the pathway for the safe navigation of dozens of ships filled with much-needed food supplies. But each ship is also carrying one of today's rarest commodities, hope. Excellencies, we need hope, and more, we need action. To ease the global food crisis, we now must urgently address the global fertilizer market crunch. This year, the world has enough food. The problem is distribution. But if the fertilizer market is not stabilized, next year's problem might be food supply itself. We already have reports of farmers in West Africa and beyond cultivating fewer crops because of the price or lack of availability of fertilizers. It is essential to continue removing all remaining obstacles to the export of Russian fertilizers and their ingredients, including ammonia. These products are not subject to sanctions, and we will keep up our efforts to eliminate indirect effects. Another major concern is the impact of high gas prices on the production of nitrogen fertilizers, and these must also be addressed seriously. Without action now, the global fertilizer shortage will quickly morph into a global food shortage. Excellencies, we need action across the board. Let's have no illusions. We are in rough seas. A winter of global discontent is on the horizon. A cost of living crisis is raging. Trust is crumbling. Inequalities are exploding. And our planet is burning. People are hurting, with the most vulnerable suffering the most. The United Nations Charter and the ideals it represents are in jeopardy. We have a duty to act, and yet we are gridlocked in colossal global dysfunction. The international community is not ready or willing to tackle the big, dramatic challenges of our age. This crisis threatens the very future of humanity and the fate of our planet. Crises like the war in Ukraine and the multiplication of conflicts around the globe, climates like the climate emergency and biodiversity loss, crises like the dire financial situation of developing countries and the fate of the Sustainable Development Goals, and crises like the lack of guardrails around promising new technologies to heal disease, connect people, and expand opportunity. In just the time since I became Secretary General, a tool has been developed to edit genes. Neurotechnology, connecting technology with the human nervous system, has progressed from idea to proof of concept. Cryptocurrencies and other blockchain technologies are widespread, but across a host of new technologies, there is a forest of red flags. Social media platforms, based on a business model that monetizes outrage, anger, and negativity, are causing untold damage to communities and societies. Hate speech, misinformation, and abuse, targeted especially at women and vulnerable groups, are proliferating. Our data is being bought and sold to influence our behavior, while spyware and surveillance are out of control, all with no regard for privacy. Artificial intelligence can compromise the integrity of information systems, the media, and indeed democracy itself. Quantum computing could destroy cybersecurity and increase the risk of malfunctions to complex systems. We don't have the beginnings of a global architecture to deal with any of these. Excellencies, progress on these issues and more is being held hostage by geopolitical tensions. Our world is in peril and paralyzed. Geopolitical divides are undermining the work of the Security Council, undermining international law, undermining trust and people's faith in democratic institutions, undermining all forms of international cooperation. We cannot go on like this. Even the various groupings set up outside the multilateral system by some members of the international community have fallen into the trap of geopolitical divides, like in the G20. At one stage, international relations seem to be moving towards a G2 world. Now we risk ending up with a G-nothing. No cooperation, no dialogue, no collective problem solving. But the reality is that we live in a world where the logic of cooperation and dialogue is the only path forward. No power or group alone can call the shots. No major global challenge can be solved with a coalition of the willing. We need a coalition of the world. Excellence, Aujourd'hui, je voudrais présenter trois domaines dans lesquels cette coalition mondiale doit de toute urgence surmonter les divisions et agir de concert. Il s'agit en premier lieu de la mission fondamentale des Nations Unies, instaurer et maintenir la paix. Une grande partie de la planète continue d'avoir les yeux rivés sur l'invasion russe en Ukraine. La guerre a déclenché une destruction et des violations massives des droits humains et des droits humanitaires internationaux.
Of human rights and international humanitarian law.
Sur la découverte des sites funéraires à Izium sont extrêmement perturbants. Des milliers de civils ont été tués, des millions de personnes ont été déplacées, des milliards d'individus dans le monde sont touchés. Nous voyons surgir la menace de divisions dangereuses entre l'Ouest et le Sud. Les risques pour la paix et la sécurité mondiale sont immenses et nous devons continuer à œuvrer pour la paix dans le respect de la Charte des Nations Unies et du droit international. Dans le même temps, les conflits et les crises humanitaires se propagent souvent loin des projecteurs. Le déficit de financement de notre appel humanitaire mondial s'élève à 32 milliards de dollars, le plus important jamais enregistré. Hélas, on ne compte plus les crises. En Afghanistan, l'économie est en ruine, plus de la moitié de la population est en proie à des niveaux de faim extrêmes, tandis que les droits humains, et en particulier les droits des femmes et des filles, sont bafoués. En République démocratique du Congo, les groupes armés de l'Est terrorisent les civils et attisent les tensions régionales. Dans la Corne de l'Afrique, une sécheresse sans précédent menace la vie et les moyens de subsistance de 22 millions de personnes. En Éthiopie, les combats ont repris, soulignant l'urgence pour les partis de cesser les hostilités et de revenir à la table des négociations sous l'égide de l'Union africaine. Haïti, les gangs détruisent les fondements même de la société. En Libye, les divisions continuent de mettre le pays en péril. En Irak, les tensions actuelles compromettent la stabilité. Et en Israël et en Palestine, les cycles de violence sous l'occupation se poursuivent. Et les perspectives de paix fondées sur une solution à deux États ne cessent de s'éloigner. Au Myanmar, les foyers de situation humanitaire et des droits humains ainsi que les conditions de sécurité s'aggravent de jour en jour.
Au Sahel,
l'insécurité et les activités terroristes atteignent des niveaux alarmants, tandis que les besoins humanitaires ne cessent de croître. En Syrie, la violence et les difficultés règnent toujours, et la liste est encore longue. Pendant ce temps, les menaces de recours aux armes nucléaires et les risques pesant sur la sécurité des centrales nucléaires ne font qu'ajouter à l'instabilité planétaire. Les parties à la conférence d'examen du traité sur la non-prolifération des armes nucléaires n'ont pas réussi à trouver de consensus et l'accord sur le nucléaire avec l'Iran semble encore lointain. Il y a toutefois quelques lueurs d'espoir. Au Yémen, la trêve nationale est fragile, mais elle tient toujours. En Colombie, le processus de paix prend racine. Et partout, nous avons besoin d'une action bien plus concertée, ancrée dans le respect du droit international et la protection des droits humains. Dans un monde qui se déchire, nous devons créer des mécanismes de dialogue et de médiation pour apaiser les divisions. Et c'est pourquoi j'ai esquissé les éléments d'un nouvel agenda pour la paix dans le rapport sur notre programme commun. Nous sommes résolus à tirer le meilleur de tous les outils diplomatiques de règlement pacifique des différends qui s'offrent à nous, comme le prévoit la Charte des Nations Unies. Négociation, enquête, médiation, conciliation, arbitrage et règlement judiciaire.
And judicial settlement.
El liderazgo y la participación de las mujeres deben estar en primer plano. Y también debemos priorizar la prevención y la consolidación de la paz. Eso significa reforzar la previsión estratégica, anticiparse a los focos de violencia que pueden instalar y hacer frente a las nuevas amenazas que suponen la ciberguerra y las armas autónomas letales. Significa asimismo ampliar el papel de los grupos regionales
reforzar el mantenimiento de la paz, intensificar el desarme y la no proliferación, prevenir y combatir el terrorismo y garantizar la rendición de cuentas. Y significa reconocer que los derechos humanos son piedras de toque de la prevención. Mi llamamiento a la acción en materia de derechos humanos destaca la centralidad de los derechos humanos, así como la de los refugiados y el derecho humanitario. En todo lo que hacemos, debemos reconocer que los derechos humanos son el camino para resolver tensiones, poner fin a los conflictos y forjar una paz duradera. Excellencies, there is another battle we must end. Our suicidal war against nature. The climate crisis is the defining issue of our time, and it must be the first priority of every government and multilateral organization. And yet, climate action is being put on the back burner, despite overwhelming public support around the world. Global greenhouse gas emissions need to be slashed by 45% by 2030, to have any hope of reaching net zero emissions by 2050. And yet, emissions are going up at record levels, on course to a 14% increase this decade. We have a rendezvous with climate disaster. I recently saw it with my own eyes in Pakistan, where one third of the country is submerged by a monsoon on steroids. We see it everywhere. Planet Earth is a victim of scorched earth policies. The past year has brought us Europe's worst heat wave since the Middle Ages. Mega drought in China, the United States and beyond. Famine stalking the Horn of Africa. 1 million species at risk of extinction. No region is untouched. And we ain't seen nothing yet. The hottest summers of today may be the coolest summers of tomorrow. Once-in-a-lifetime climate shocks may soon become once-a-year events. And with every climate disaster, we know that women and girls are the most affected. The climate crisis is a case study in moral and economic injustice. The G20 emits 80% of all greenhouse gas emissions. But the poorest and most vulnerable, those who contributed least to this crisis, are bearing its most brutal impacts. Meanwhile, the fossil fuel industry is feasting on hundreds of billions of dollars in subsidies and windfall profits while households' budgets shrink and our planet burns. Excellencies, let's tell it like it is. Our world is addicted to fossil fuels, and it's time for an intervention. We need to hold fossil fuel companies and their enablers to account. And that includes the banks, private equity, asset managers, and other financial institutions that continue to invest and underwrite carbon pollution. It includes the massive public relations machine raking in billions to shield the fossil fuel industry from scrutiny, just as they did for the tobacco industry decades before. Lobbyists and spin doctors have spewed harmful misinformation. Fossil fuel interests need to spend less time averting a PR disaster and more time averting a planetary one. Of course, fossil fuels cannot be shut down overnight. A just transition means leaving no person or country behind. But it's high time to put fossil fuel producers, investors, and enablers on notice. Polluters must pay. And today I'm calling on all developed economies to tax the windfall profits of fossil fuel companies. Those funds should be redirected in two ways: to countries suffering loss and damage caused by the climate crisis, and to people struggling with rising food and energy prices. As you heard to the COP27 UN climate conference in Egypt, I appeal to all leaders to realize the goals of the Paris Agreement. Lift your climate ambition. Listen to your people's calls for change. Invest in solutions that lead to sustainable economic growth. And let me point to three. First, renewable energy. It generates three times more jobs. It's already cheaper than fossil fuels, and it's the best way to energy security, stable prices, and new industries. But developing countries need help to make this shift. including through international coalitions to support just energy transitions in key emerging economies. Second, helping countries adapt to worsening climate shocks. Resilience building in developing countries is a smart investment in a reliable supply chains, regional stability, and orderly migration. Last year in Glasgow, developed countries agreed to double adaptation funding by 2025. These must be delivered in full as a starting point. At minimum, adaptation must make up half of all climate finance. And multilateral development banks must step up and deliver. Major economies are their shareholders and must make it happen. Third, addressing loss and damage for disasters. It's high time to move beyond endless discussions. Vulnerable countries need meaningful action. Loss and damage are happening now, hurting people and economies now, and must be addressed now, starting at COP27. This is a fundamental question of climate justice, international solidarity, and trust. And at the same time, we must make sure that every person, community, and nation has access to effective early warning systems within the next 5 years. And we must address the biodiversity crisis by making the December UN Biodiversity Conference a success. The world must agree on a post-2020 global biodiversity framework, one that sets ambitious targets to halt and reverse biodiversity loss, provides adequate financing, and eliminates harmful subsidies that destroy ecosystems on which we all depend. And I also urge you to intensify efforts to finalize an international legally binding agreement to conserve and sustainably use marine biological diversity. We must protect the ocean now and for the future. Excellencies, the climate crisis is coming on top of other heavy weather. A once-in-a-generation global cost-of-living crisis is unfolding, turbocharged by the war in Ukraine. Some 94 countries, home to 1.6 billion people, many in Africa, face a perfect storm. Economic and social fallout from the pandemic, soaring food and energy prices, crushing debt burdens, spiraling inflation, and the lack of access to finance. These cascading crises are feeding on each other, compounding inequalities, creating devastating hardship, delaying the energy transition, and threatening global financial meltdown. Social unrest is inevitable, with conflict not far behind. And it doesn't have to be this way. A world without extreme poverty, want, or hunger is not an impossible dream. It is within reach. This is the world envisaged by the 2030 Agenda and the Sustainable Development Goals. But it is not the world we seem to have chosen. Because of our collective decisions, sustainable development everywhere is at risk. The SDGs are issuing an SOS. Even the most fundamental goals on poverty, hunger, and education are going into reverse. More people are poor. More people are hungry, more people are being denied healthcare and education. Gender equality is going backwards, and women's lives are getting worse, from poverty to choices around sexual and reproductive health to their personal security. Excellencies, developing countries are getting hit from all sides, and we need concerted action. Today, I'm calling for the launch of an SDG stimulus led by the G20, to massively boost sustainable development for developing countries. The upcoming G20 summit in Bali is the place to start. This SDG stimulus has four components. First, multilateral development banks, the World Bank and regional counterparts, must increase concessional funding to developing countries linked to investments in the Sustainable Development Goals. And the banks themselves need more finance immediately. And then they need to lift their borrowing conditions and increase their appetite for risk so the funds reach all countries in need. Developing countries, particularly small island developing states, face too many obstacles in accessing the finance they need to invest in their people and their future. Second, debt relief. the debt service suspension initiative should be extended and enhanced. But we also need an effective mechanism of debt relief for developing countries, including middle-income countries in debt distress. Creditors should consider debt reduction mechanisms, such as debt climate adaptation swaps. And this could have saved lives and livelihoods in Pakistan, which is drowning not only in flood water, but in debt. Lending criteria should go beyond gross domestic product and include all the dimensions of vulnerability that affect developing countries. Third, an expansion of liquidity. I urge International Monetary Fund and major central banks to expand their liquidity facilities and currency lines immediately and significantly. Special drawing rights play an important role in enabling developing countries to invest in recovery and the SDGs. But they were distributed according to existing quotas, benefiting those who need them least. We have been waiting for a reallocation for 19 months, and the amounts we hear about are minimal. A new allocation of special drawing rights must be handled differently, based on justice and solidarity with developing countries. Fourth, I call on governments to empower specialized funds like Gavi, the Global Fund, and the Green Climate Fund. G20 economies should underwrite an expansion of these funds as additional financing for the SDGs. Excellencies, let me be clear. The SDG stimulus I'm proposing is essential, but it is only an interim measure. Today's global financial system was created by rich countries to serve their interests many decades ago. It expands and entrenches inequalities. It requires deep structural reform. And my report on our common agenda proposes a new global deal to rebalance power and resources between developed and developing countries. African countries in particular are underrepresented in global institutions. I hope member states will seize the opportunity to turn these ideas into concrete solutions, including at the Summit of the Future in 2024. Excellencies, the divergence between developed and developing countries, between North and South, between the privileged and the rest, is becoming more dangerous by the day. It is at the root of geopolitical tensions and lack of trust that poison every area of global cooperation, from vaccines to sanctions to trade. But by acting as one, we can nurture fragile shoots of hope. The hope found in climate and peace activists around the world, calling out for change and demanding better of their leaders. The hope found in young people working every day for a better, more peaceful future. The hope found in women and girls living and fighting for those still being denied their basic human rights. The hope found throughout civil society seeking ways to build more just and equal communities and countries. And the hope found in science and academia, racing to stay ahead of deadly diseases and then the COVID-19 pandemic. The hope found in humanitarian heroes, rushing to deliver life-saving aid around the world. The United Nations stands with them all. We know lofty ideals must be made real in people's lives. So let's develop common solutions to common problems, grounded in goodwill, trust, and the rights shared by every human being. Let's work as one, a coalition of the world, as United Nations. Thank you.
I thank the Secretary General. The Assembly will now turn to Agenda Item 8, entitled General Debate. Mr. Secretary General, distinguished heads of state and government, excellencies, friends, the world needs solutions through solidarity, sustainability, and science. Solutions because we have drafted many treaties, set excellent goals, yet have taken too little action. We need solidarity because inequalities have reached record heights. We need sustainability because we owe it to our children to leave behind a livable world. We need science because it offers us neutral evidence for our actions. My sincere gratitude goes to all member states, especially to Hungary and the Eastern European Group for giving me the mandate to turn this motto into reality. Excellencies, we gather today at the most consequential moment of the last four decades. Des chaleurs extrêmes aux inondations dévastatrices.
Extreme Le changement flooding, climatique extreme heat, climate change.
Nos communautés.
Notre consommation
et nos méthodes de production lacèrent notre planète de ses sols
are tearing our planet apart from the earth to
Nous
the sky.
Vivons dans un état de crise humanitaire permanent.
Ongoing state of humanitarian crisis.
أكثر من 300 مليون شخص في حاجة ماسة للمساعدات الإنسانية والحماية وذلك بزيادة قدرها 10% منذ يناير.
And this is an increase of 10%
كما وصلت أزمة الجو العالمية إلى المستويات تنذر بالخطر بسبب تغيير المناخ ونزاعات وجائحة COVID-19
conflict and the COVID-19 pandemic.
وفي الأشهر الستة الماضية دفع تضخم أسعار الغذاء والطاقة 70 مليون شخص إلى الأقل
energy
إلى الفقر.
Crisis have pushed at least 70 million people into poverty.
Инфляция тем временем находится на самом высоком за 40 лет уровне.
At the highest level over the past 40 years.
Всего населения
Земли. One fourth of the entire population
проживает в районах, охваченных конфликтами, боевыми действиями,
in areas where armed hostilities take place or where there is political instability.
Редко, когда насилие по всему миру бывало столь жестоким.
As harsh throughout the world before.
Who would have imagined that war would return to Europe? That the nuclear threat would be back in political discourse to settle a dispute with a neighbor? It has been 203 days since the General Assembly adopted a resolution condemning the military aggression against Ukraine. Unfortunately, the bloodshed and the suffering have not stopped yet. In that time, the United Nations, as we heard, and its partners have offered food and shelter to millions of refugees from that country. A landmark agreement on commercial grain exports from the world's best breadbasket offers hope. Diplomacy is at work to release fertilizers so that the shortage we see today do not become the famines of the next year. UN nuclear inspectors are at one of Europe's key nuclear sites, preventing a possible catastrophe. Excellencies, the theme of our 77th general debate is a watershed moment, transformative solutions to interlocking challenges. I stand in solidarity with the people of Pakistan, where devastating floods washed away hundreds of villages. You have seen the heart-wrenching scenes of devastation. This can be a window into our future. However, in tackling climate change, we have the solutions. These are rooted in the advancement we have made in science cooperation and climate diplomacy. But we have to want to put them in practice. The International Panel on Climate Change has proven an invaluable tool for supporting political decisions to combat climate change and to adapt to its consequences. We should consider replicating its success in the areas of water, energy, food, and biodiversity. This would give us a universally accepted scientific foundation for action. Once this high-level week is over, I plan to launch a series of consultations with the scientific community, asking them to help us, bringing the knowledge from microphones, from microscopes to microphones. The 77th session of the General Assembly will be key to preparing the SDG Summit in 2023 and the Summit of the Future in 2024. Next year, we will assess SDG 6 at the UN Voter Conference, the first since 1977. This call could not be more urgent. Water is set to be the next major driver of conflict worldwide. The problem of water is threefold: too much, not enough, not safe. We have the chance to make a difference in the lives of 2.1 billion people who lack access to clean water. Let us cooperate to make the voter action agenda as transformational, practical, and actionable as possible. During this session, we will also assess the Sendai framework and come to conclusions to improve resilience against disasters. It is vital that these opportunities lead to substantive outcomes. The building blocks for transformation are at our disposal: the 2030 Agenda, the Sendai Framework, the Paris Agreement, the Addis Ababa Program of Action, and our common agenda all point in the same direction. They describe the world we want and offer the avenues to get there. I'm encouraged that the Secretary General's proposals and the important initiatives by member states mutually support each other. The challenges are great, and they are interconnected, but they are not insurmountable. Ladies and gentlemen, without universal respect to the rule of law, it is all too easy to rapidly slide into treacherous territory. As we all know, in time of crisis, human rights are the first to be compromised. When human rights are under threat, it is our smoke signal, our call to action. It would be remiss to speak of human rights without addressing a fundamental issue found to be lacking in most societies around the world. It is women's rights. It is simply unacceptable that every third woman experiences violence in her lifetime. As we speak, half of humanity is all too often excluded from decision-making and leadership. But we need every man and woman to live their lives to their fullest potential. It is only by ensuring the inclusion of all, valuing the knowledge of all, that we will find solutions to the challenges we face. This afternoon's Anga platform of women leaders, organized in collaboration with UN Women, may be an answer to this call. Women heads of state and government will offer their solutions to society's complex problems. Data shows that crisis response is more effective when women take the lead. I encourage you to engage substantively with this issue. It has to do with equity and equality, but above all, human dignity. Excellencies, in all these issues, in all our endeavors, I look forward to working closely with the Secretary General, the Security Council, ECOSOC, and other key relevant institutions of the United Nations. I stand ready to support Member States to identify transformative, impact-oriented, systemic, and sustainable solutions. I promise to cooperate with all stakeholders, civil society, young people, women, and scientific community, to name but a few. UN agencies, funds, and programs are critical to bringing our efforts out of this hole and into our communities. To deliver on the agenda requested by the Member States, I count on your constructive engagement, cooperation, and mutual respect to each other. I emphasize that the revitalization of both the United Nations and the General Assembly must continue. Our ability to competently improve our organization will determine its relevance in the eyes of people around the world. I want to advance negotiations on Security Council reform. It is high time that the Council represents the world's population more equally and that it reflects 21st century realities. This is a matter of credibility to our entire organization and our multilateral order. Ladies and gentlemen, crisis management and transformation will require our consistent efforts, way beyond one session of the General Assembly. In that spirit, let me finish with some timeless words of wisdom about chances and the risk of letting them pass us by. Things get better when we make them better. Things go wrong when we fail to seize the opportunities before us. Our opportunity is here and now. Let us act. I thank you. Distinguished delegates, before giving the floor to the first speaker for this morning, I would like to remind members that the list of speakers for the general debate has been established on the agreed basis that statements should be no longer than 15 minutes. To enable all speakers to be heard in a given meeting. Within this time frame, I would like to appeal to speakers to deliver their statement at a reasonable pace so that interpretation into the other official United Nations languages may be provided properly. I would also like to draw your attention to the decision taken by the General Assembly at previous sessions, namely that the practice of expressing congratulations inside the General Assembly hall after a speech has been delivered is strongly discouraged. After delivering their statements from the rostrum, speakers are invited to exit the General Assembly hall through room GA200, located behind the podium, before returning to their seats. May I take it that the General Assembly agrees to proceed in this manner during the general debate of the 77th session? It is so decided. Finally, I should like to draw the attention of members that during the general debate, official photographs of all the speakers are taken by the Department of Global Communications. Members interested in obtaining these photographs are requested to contact the Photo Library of the United Nations. The Assembly will hear an address by His Excellency Jair Messias Bolsonaro, President of the Federal Republic of Brazil. I request the protocol to escort His Excellency. On behalf of the General Assembly, I have the honor to welcome His Excellency Jair Messias Bolsonaro, President of the Federal Republic of Brazil, and to invite him to address the Assembly.
Okay.
Hello, this is the English channel.
Okay.
This is the English channel.
Senhor Shabat Kourosi,
presidente
da 77ª Assembleia Geral das Nações Unidas,
senhor Antônio Guterres, secretário-geral
das Nações Unidas, senhoras e senhores, chefes de Estado, de governo e de delegações, senhoras e senhores, começo por cumprimentá-lo, embaixador Shabat Kourosi, pela eleição para presidir esta Assembleia Geral. Esteja certo de contar com o apoio do Brasil. O tema escolhido para este debate geral gira em torno de um conceito que se aplica perfeitamente ao momento que vivemos, um divisor de águas. Senhor Presidente, nossa responsabilidade coletiva nessa Assembleia Geral é compreender o alcance dos desafios que compõem esse divisor de águas e, a partir daí, construir respostas que tirem sua força dos objetivos que são comuns a todos nós. A tarefa não é simples, mas, a rigor, não temos alternativa. Esse esforço tem de começar no interior de cada dos nossos países. Antes de tudo, é aquilo que realizamos no plano interno que dá a medida da autoridade com que agimos no plano internacional. Deixe-me falar da perspectiva do meu país. Quando o Brasil se manifesta sobre a agenda da saúde pública, fazemos isso com a autoridade de governo que, durante a pandemia da Covid-19, não poupou esforços para salvar vidas e preservar empregos. Como tantos outros países, concentramos nossa atenção desde a primeira hora em garantir um auxílio financeiro emergencial aos mais necessitados. O nosso objetivo foi proteger a renda das famílias para que elas conseguissem enfrentar as dificuldades econômicas decorrentes da pandemia. Beneficiamos mais de 68 milhões de pessoas, o equivalente a 1/3 da nossa população. Em paralelo, lançamos um amplo programa de imunização, inclusive com produção doméstica de vacinas. Somos uma nação com 210 milhões de habitantes e já temos mais de 80% da população vacinada contra a Covid-19. Todos foram vacinados de forma voluntária, respeitando a liberdade individual de cada um.
of one's individual
forma,
freedom.
No terreno da economia,
Likewise,
o Brasil traz a autoridade dos países
Brazil has the legitimate authority
de
um crescimento sustentável, for the sake of sustainable and inclusive growth, has reforms
e melhoria das
condições
de vida de sua população.
The standards of living of
no meu
her
governo,
population.
Extirpamos a
Under my administration, we uprooted
no
the systemic corruption
Somente
that existed
o período
in the country. Between 2003 and 2015 alone, a period in which the left-wing presided over in Brazil, indebtedness levels at the oil state company Petrobras due to mismanagement and politically driven appointments and favors, as well as the diversion of funds reached up to $170 billion. The person responsible for that was convicted, unanimously convicted in three different courts.
E pagamos para a Bolsa Americana outro bilhão por perdas de seus acionistas. Esse é o Brasil do passado. Aprimoramos os serviços públicos com redução de custos e investimentos em ciência e tecnologia. Hoje, por exemplo, o Brasil é o sétimo país mais digitalizado do mundo. São 135 milhões de pessoas que acessam 4.900 serviços do meu governo. O Brasil foi pioneiro na implantação 900 serviços na América Latina. Mas vamos adiante em uma abrangente pauta de privatizações e concessões, com ênfase na infraestrutura. Concluímos o projeto de transposição do Rio São Francisco, levando água para o Nordeste brasileiro. Adotamos novos marcos regulatórios, como
o
do saneamento básico, o das ferrovias,
such as
o do gás natural.
Railways,
Além disso, melhoramos o ambiente de negócio com a lei da liberdade econômica e a lei de startups. Como resultado, criamos oportunidades para os jovens empreender e ter empregos de qualidade.
Coroando
todo esse esforço de modernização da economia brasileira, estamos avançando a passo largo para o ingresso do Brasil como membro pleno da Organização para a Cooperação e Desenvolvimento Econômico, a OCDE. Apesar da crise mundial, o Brasil chega ao final de 2022 com uma economia em plena recuperação. Temos emprego em alta e inflação em baixa. A economia voltou a crescer. A pobreza aumentou em todo o mundo sob o impacto da pandemia. No Brasil, ela já começou a cair de forma acentuada. Os números falam por si só. A estimativa é de que, no final de 2022, 4% das famílias brasileiras estejam vivendo abaixo da linha da pobreza extrema. Em 2019, era 5,1%. Isso representa uma queda de mais de 20%.
Reflects a
o
drop
Auxílio
of more
Brasil,
than 20%.
De renda mínima,
the Brazil Aid
Program,
a minimum income country designed and established by my administration during the pandemic, currently meets the needs of 20 million families and pays out $4 a day to the poorest families in the country.
Chegando a
Employment fell by 5 percentage points, reaching 9.1%, a rate not
Reduzimos
seen in 7 years. We have lowered inflation with an estimate of less than 7% for 2022. I am pleased to announce that we have had unprecedented deflation in Brazil in the months of July
Desde
and August this year. Since June, the price of gasoline
Hoje,
has dropped by more than 30%. Today,
1 liter
of gasoline in Brazil costs about
O preço da energia elétrica também teve uma queda de mais de 15%. Quero ressaltar que o custo da energia não caiu por causa de tabelamento de preços ou qualquer outro tipo de intervenção federal. Foi resultado de uma política de racionalização de impostos formulada e implementada com apoio do Congresso Nacional. Em 2021, o Brasil foi o quarto maior destino de investimentos estrangeiros direto no mundo. Nosso O comércio exterior alcançou a marca histórica de 39% do PIB, mesmo diminuindo ou zerando impostos de milhares de produtos. No plano interno, também estamos batendo recordes em três áreas.
Arrecadação
fiscal, lucro das empresas estatais,
tax
collection,
state-owned company profit levels, and the public debt-to-GDP ratio. In fact, in 2021, we had a surplus in the consolidated results or figures for national accounts. Brazilian GDP increased by 1.2% in the second quarter, and the forecast is for up to 3% in 2022.
we enjoy the peace of mind of those who are working in the right path, the path to share prosperity among Brazilians, and beyond that, prosperity shared with our neighbors and other partners worldwide. This is precisely what we see, for example, in food production. 4 decades ago, Brazil used to be a food importer. Today, we are one of the world's largest food exporters. And this has only been possible thanks to heavy investments in science and innovation with a view to boosting productivity, yield levels, and sustainability. May I here pay a tribute to Mr. Alisson Paulinelli, the Brazilian candidate for the Nobel Peace Prize, for his role in expanding the Brazilian agricultural frontier with the use of new technologies. This year, Brazil has already started the harvest, or the largest grain harvest in our history. We estimate it to be at least 270 million tons. In a few years, Brazil will also make the transition from net importer of wheat to a net exporter of wheat. For the 2022-2023 period, the forecast is that our total production will exceed 300 million tons. As stated by Director General of the World Trade Organization in a recent visit to Brazil, she stated that if it were not for Brazilian agribusiness, the planet would go hungry, since we feed more than 1 billion people worldwide. Our agribusiness is a source of national pride. Mr. President, I also wish to call to mind here that also in the field of sustainable development, Brazil's track record of achievements is a source of credibility for our country's international action. As regards the environment and sustainable development, Brazil is part of the solution and stands as a reference to the world. 2/3 of all of the Brazilian territory remain untouched, covered by native vegetation, precisely as it were when Brazil was first discovered in the 1500s. In the Brazilian Amazon region, an area as big as Western Europe, more than 80% of the rainforest remains untouched and pristine. Contrary to what is often reported by the mainstream national and international media, it is absolutely key in the sense that when taking care of the environment, we do not overlook people. The Amazon region is home to more than 20 million people, including indigenous people and riverside dwellers, whose livelihood depends on some form of economic use of the forest. We have made, or we have brought internet connectivity to more than 100,000 rural schools and more than 500 indigenous communities. Brazil began its energy transition almost half a century ago in response to the oil crisis of that time. Today, we have a modern and sustainable biofuel industry, an industry that currently contributes, positively contributes to the cleanest energy mix among G20 countries. About 84% of our electricity or energy mix is currently renewable, and this is a goal that many developed countries hope to achieve only after 2040 or 2050. Last year, Brazil was chosen or declared by the United Nations as a global transition for energy transition. Have the potential to become a major global exporter of clean energy. We have a surplus already being built up, which can reach more than 100 gigawatts between biomass, onshore wind projects, and solar projects, in addition to the untapped opportunity of 700 gigawatt offshore wind farms, with one of the lowest production costs in the world. These sources will produce green hydrogen for export. Part of this 100% clean energy opens the possibility for us to become suppliers of highly competitive industrial projects, especially in the Brazilian Northeast, with one of the smallest carbon footprints in the world. The sustainable development agenda is impacted in many ways by threats to international peace and security. We all built the United Nations from
the ruins of the Second World War in the last century. What motivated us back then was the determination to avoid a repetition of the cycle of destruction that marked the first half of the 20th century. To a certain extent, in hindsight, we can say that we were successful. But today, the conflict in Ukraine serves as a warning. A reform of the UN system is essential for us to find world peace. In the specific case of the Security Council, after 25 years of debate, it is clear that we must look for innovative solutions. Brazil addresses this topic based on an experience that goes way back and dates back to the very beginnings of the United Nations. It is now the 11th time that we hold a non-permanent seat at the UN Security Council. We have sought to offer our very best to achieve peaceful and negotiated solutions to international conflicts, always guided by the UN Charter and international law. Brazil also has an extensive history of participation in UN peacekeeping operations. From Suez to Angola, from Haiti to Lebanon, we have always supported peacekeeping. We have also contributed to peace by opening up our borders to those seeking a chance to restart their lives in our country. Since 2018, over 6 million Venezuelan brothers have been forced to leave their country. Many of them came to Brazil. Our response to this challenge was Operation Welcome, which has become an international benchmark reference. More than 350,000 Venezuelan nationals have found in Brazilian territory emergency assistance, protection, documentation, and the possibility of a fresh start. All of them have had access to the labor market, to public services, and to social benefits. In recent months, around 600 Venezuelans have arrived in Brazil every day on foot, the vast majority of which are women and children, weighing on average 15 kilos less than before, and running away from violence and hunger. The Brazilian humanitarian reception policy goes beyond Venezuela. We have also welcomed Haitians, Syrians, Afghans, and Ukrainians. Mr. President, the conflict in Ukraine has been going on for 7 months already, and it is a source of great concern, not only in Europe, but throughout the world. First of all, I would like to reiterate Brazil's gratitude to the countries that helped with the evacuation of Brazilian nationals who were in Ukraine when the conflict first started, especially Slovakia, Hungary, Poland, Romania, and the Czech Republic. Thank you very much. The evacuation operation was successful. We left no one behind, not even their pets.
Diante do conflito em si,
regarding the
o Brasil
conflict in itself,
tem se pautado
Brazil
pelos princípios do direito internacional e da Carta da ONU.
Princípios
que estão consagrados também em nossa Constituição. Defendemos um cessar-fogo imediato, a proteção de civis e não combatentes, a preservação da infraestrutura crítica para assistência à população e a manutenção de todos os canais de diálogo entre as partes em conflito.
Between the parties
at
conflict. These are the first steps towards achieving a solution that will be long-lasting and sustainable. And we have been working in that direction. At the United Nations and also elsewhere, we have tried to avoid hampering the channels of dialogue as a result of polarization around the conflict. Accordingly, we are against diplomatic and economic isolation. The effects of the conflict can already be felt in the world prices of foodstuffs, fuel, and other raw materials. All of this impact drives us all away from the sustainable development goals. Countries that once presented themselves as leaders of the low-carbon economy have now turned to dirty sources of energy. This is a serious setback for the environment. We support all efforts to reduce the economic impacts of this crisis. But we do not believe that the best way is to adopt one-sided or unilateral and selective sanctions that are inconsistent with international law. These measures have harmed economic recovery and have threatened the human rights of vulnerable populations, including in European countries. The solution to the conflict in Ukraine will only
possibly be achieved through negotiation and dialogue. I make an appeal to the parties as well as to the entire international community. Let us not miss any opportunity to end the conflict and ensure peace. The stability, security, and prosperity of humankind are at serious risk if the conflict continues.
Mr. President,
I have been an unconditional supporter of freedom of speech. Moreover, under my administration, Brazil has made an effort to bring the right to freedom of religion to the very core of the international human rights agenda. It is essential to ensure that everyone has the right to freely worship and practice their religious orientation without any discrimination whatsoever. I would like to inform here that Brazil is ready, stands ready to welcome the Catholic priests and nuns who have suffered prosecution, rather, have suffered persecution by the dictatorial regime in Nicaragua. Brazil repudiates religious persecution wherever it may occur in the world. Other fundamental values for Brazilian society with implications to the human rights agenda include the defense of family values, the right to life since conception, the right to self-defense, and the repudiation of gender ideology. I would also like to underscore the priority we have attached to women's rights and protection. Our efforts to sanction over 70 legal norms on the subject since the very beginning of my administration in 2019 is thorough evidence of this commitment. We fight violence against women very strictly. It is part and parcel of our broader priority to ensure public security and safety for all Brazilians. The results are visible in our government figures. A 7.7% drop in the number of murders of women and a decrease in the general number of deaths by murder. In 2017, there were 30 deaths per 100,000 inhabitants. Now there are only 17. Violence in rural areas has also plummeted at the same time as land tenure by the most in need has increased. Under my administration, we have delivered 400,000 rural property land title deeds, 80% of which given to women. In Brazil, we work to ensure that we have strong, independent women so that they can get wherever they wish. First Lady Michelle Bolsonaro has given a new meaning to volunteer work since 2019, with special attention to people with disabilities and rare diseases. Mr. President, Mr. Secretary General, Heads of State and Government, ladies and gentlemen, last September 7th, Brazil celebrated 200 years of history as an independent nation. Millions of Brazilians took to the streets, called upon by their government, and wearing the colors of their flag, our flag. It was the largest civic demonstration in the history of our country, a people that believes in God, the homeland, family, and freedom. Thank you all very much.
On behalf of the Assembly, I wish to thank the President of the Federal Republic of Brazil for the statement just made, and I request the protocol to escort His Excellency. The Assembly will hear the address by His Excellency Macky Sall, President of the Republic of Senegal. I request the protocol to escort His Excellency. On behalf of the General Assembly, I have the honor to welcome His Excellency Macky Sall, President of the Republic of Senegal, and invite him to address the Assembly.
Merci beaucoup.
Thank you very much.
Monsieur le Président de l'Assemblée Générale,
Mr. President of the General Assembly,
chers collègues,
dear colleagues,
Monsieur le Secrétaire Général,
Secretary
Mesdames,
General,
Messieurs,
ladies and gentlemen,
distingués délégués,
distinguished delegates,
Monsieur le Président,
Mr. President,
au nom de l'Union africaine,
of the African Union,
je remercie votre prédécesseur
like
et vous adresse tous nos voeux de succès à la présidence de notre session. Je renouvelle au secrétaire général Antonio Guterres notre soutien dans l'exercice de sa délicate mission au service des États membres. Depuis notre dernière session,
since our last session,
le monde est devenu plus dangereux
has become more dangerous
et plus incertain.
And more uncertain.
sous l'emprise
under
combinée
the combined
du réchauffement climatique,
of global warming,
des périls sécuritaires
security
et sanitaires,
and health perils,
ainsi que de la guerre
and
en Ukraine.
The war in Ukraine.
Le thème de cette session montre à quel point il urge d'agir ensemble
the urgent need to
pour
act together,
apaiser
to
les
ease
tensions,
tensions,
soigner notre
to
planète,
heal our planet,
réduire les inégalités persistantes nord-sud
north-south inequalities,
et redonner sens au multilatéralisme.
And reinstate the importance
le Conseil
of
de sécurité est interpellé
the Security Council
au premier chef
is called upon
afin qu'il traite de la même
to
manière
address this
toutes les menaces à la paix et à la
first
sécurité
and foremost,
internationale,
to make sure that all threats to international peace and security, including in Africa,
le terrorisme qui gagne du terrain
are handled
sur le
in
continent
the same way.
N'est pas qu'une
which is
affaire
gaining
africaine.
Ground on the continent is
c'est
not just an African matter. It is a global threat
de la
that falls under the primary responsibility of the Council
garant du mécanisme
as it
de
is the guarantor of the collective security mechanism under the charter of our organization.
Ainsi, invitons-nous le
we
conseil
therefore
à mieux
urge
s'engager
the Council
avec nous
to engage more
dans la
with
lutte
us
contre le terrorisme
in the
en
fight
Afrique
against terrorism in Africa
avec des mandats
and
plus
to do
adaptés
this with more appropriate
et des
mandates
moyens plus conséquents
and more substantial resources.
En outre, l'Union africaine
furthermore,
appelle
the African
une fois
Union
de plus
once again
à la levée des sanctions étrangères contre le
Zimbabwe.
Ces mesures sévères
these harsh
continuent
measures
de nourrir un sentiment d'injustice contre tout un peuple
against
et d'aggraver ses souffrances
and to
en
aggravate their
de crise profonde.
In these times of deep
au Proche-Orient, nous
in
réitérons
East,
le droit du peuple
we
palestinien
the right of
à
the Palestinian
un État viable
to
coexistant
a viable
pacifiquement
state
avec l'État d'Israël,
side by side
chacun
in peace with the
à
state
l'intérieur
of Israel,
de frontières sûres et internationalement
and
reconnues.
Internationally recognized borders.
Nous appelons
we call
à la désescalade
for a de-escalation
et à la cessation des hostilités
and a cessation of
en
Ukraine. Hostilities in Ukraine.
Pour une solution négociée
as well as for a negotiated solution to
le
avoid
catastrophique
the catastrophic
d'un conflit potentiellement
of a
mondial.
Global conflict.
La négociation
the
et la discussion sont les meilleures armes dont nous disposons pour promouvoir la paix. Je lance
peace.
Un appel pour la mise en place
to
d'une mission de médiation de haut niveau
a high-level mediation mission
à laquelle l'Union africaine est prête à apporter sa contribution.
Which the African Union stands ready
près
to
de
contribute.
80 ans après la naissance du système
nearly
des Nations Unies et des institutions
the
de Bretton Woods,
Nations system and the
il est temps d'instaurer une gouvernance mondiale plus juste,
a fairer,
plus inclusive
more inclusive global
et
governance
plus adaptée
that
aux
is
réalités
more adapted
de notre temps.
To the realities of our time.
Il est temps de vaincre les réticences et de construire
the
les narratifs
and to deconstruct
qui persistent
the narratives
à confiner l'Afrique
that persist
à la marge
in confining
des
Africa to the margins of decision-making circles.
Il est temps
it is
de faire droit à la juste et légitime revendication africaine
just and
sur la réforme du Conseil de
sécurité
reform, telle que reflétée dans le consensus
d'Iselwini.
Dans le même esprit,
vein,
je rappelle notre demande d'octroi d'un siège à l'Union africaine au sein du G20 pour que l'Afrique puisse enfin se faire représenter là où se prennent les décisions qui engagent
1,4 milliard
d'Africains. Je remercie chaleureusement les partenaires qui nous ont déjà exprimé leur soutien et invite les autres
and invite
à considérer
others
favorablement
to give
notre
favorable consideration to our candidacy.
Au titre de la gouvernance économique et financière,
with respect to economic and financial
j'attire
governance,
l'attention de l'Assemblée générale sur le rapport 2022 sur le financement du développement durable réalisé par une soixantaine d'institutions multilatérales dont le Fonds monétaire international, la Banque mondiale, le Comité de Bâle sur la supervision bancaire, l'Association internationale des régulateurs de l'assurance et le Conseil de stabilité financière. Ce rapport relève les insuffisances dans les procédés d'évaluation des agences de notation et souligne l'importance d'appliquer des méthodologies transparentes afin de ne pas miner la confiance dans les notations. Nous sommes préoccupés par le fait que la perception du risque en Afrique continue d'être plus élevée que le risque réel, ce qui renchérit les primes d'assurance et pénalise la compétitivité de nos économies. C'est pourquoi l'Afrique renouvelle sa proposition au groupe de réponse à la crise mondiale sur l'alimentation, l'énergie et les finances afin qu'il engage en rapport avec le G20, le FMI et la Banque mondiale, un dialogue constructif avec les agences de notation sur l'amélioration de leurs méthodes de travail et d'évaluation. Dans le même esprit, face à l'ampleur inédite de la crise économique mondiale, l'Union africaine réitère son appel pour la réallocation partielle des droits de tirage spéciaux si nécessaire pour les pays en développement dans un premier temps et la mise en œuvre de l'initiative du G20
and the implementation
de suspension of the G20
debt service suspension
ce
initiative.
Choc, mesdames et messieurs, sans précédent,
ladies and gentlemen, the unprecedented shock further destabilizes the weakest economies and makes their need
en liquidité
for liquidity ever more pressing
les effets
so as to mitigate
de l'inflation généralisée
of widespread inflation
et soutenir les ménages
and support
et les couches sociales les plus vulnérables,
vulnerable households and social strata,
les jeunes
especially
et les femmes.
The young people and women.
S'y ajoute
in addition
la prise
to that,
en charge des urgences
the need
sanitaires nouvelles ou anciennes,
new and old health
dont le
emergencies,
cancer,
including cancer.
Le cancer, un tueur silencieux
the silent killer
qui continue de faire des millions
de
victimes
millions
à travers
of
le
lives
monde.
Across the world.
J'appelle à la mobilisation en faveur de la campagne Race of Hope
in favor
de l'Agence internationale de l'énergie atomique
International Atomic
pour
Energy
le renforcement
Agency's
des capacités des pays membres, africains en particulier, dans la lutte contre le cancer grâce aux technologies nucléaires telles que l'imagerie médicale,
imaging,
la médecine nucléaire et la radiothérapie.
And radiotherapy.
Monsieur le Président,
Mr. President,
Mesdames et Messieurs,
ladies and gentlemen,
à quelques semaines de la COP27 de Sharm el-Sheikh, l'Afrique renouvelle son attachement à l'accord de Paris sur le climat.
To the Paris Climate Agreement.
En même temps, nous souhaitons parvenir à un consensus pour une transition énergétique juste et équitable, comme ce fut le cas
as
au sommet Afrique-Europe de février dernier,
February,
à la session élargie du sommet du G7 en juin et récemment
June,
au forum de Rotterdam
recently,
sur le financement de l'adaptation en Afrique. Il est légitime et juste et équitable que l'Afrique, continent le plus en retard sur le processus d'industrialisation, continent le moins pollueur.
The least and lacks
il est donc juste que l'Afrique exploite ses ressources
in the industrialization process
pour disposer d'une énergie de base afin d'améliorer la compétitivité
so
de son économie
the of its
et réaliser l'accès universel
universal access to electricity.
Je rappelle
I will recall
qu'à ce jour,
that today,
plus de 600 millions d'Africains vivent encore sans électricité.
Still live without electricity.
Travaillons également
Let us
à la réalisation de l'objectif de 100 milliards de dollars par an en appui aux efforts d'adaptation des pays en développement et au financement du programme d'accélération de l'adaptation en Afrique sous l'égide de la Banque africaine de développement et du Centre mondial pour l'adaptation. Au demeurant, nous considérons le financement de l'adaptation non comme de l'aide, mais comme une contribution des pays industrialisés à un partenariat mondial solidaire en contrepartie des efforts que fournissent les pays en développement pour éviter les schémas pollueurs qui ont plongé la planète dans l'état d'urgence climatique actuel. Monsieur le Président, au-delà des urgences conjoncturelles, je suis venu porter le message d'un continent déterminé à travailler avec tous ses partenaires dans une éthique relationnelle de dialogue confiant et de respect réciproque. Je suis venu dire que l'Afrique a assez subi le fardeau de l'histoire.
Of the burden
qu'elle
of
ne veut pas être le foyer d'une nouvelle guerre froide, mais plutôt un pôle de stabilité et d'opportunité ouvert à tous ses partenaires sur une base mutuellement bénéfique. Je suis venu dire que nous n'ignorons pas l'Afrique des problèmes qu'il faut pacifier et stabiliser.
Which need to be pacified and stabilized.
Que nous avons
But I have also
aussi
come to say
l'Afrique
that we also have Africa as a provider of solutions
carrés,
with an area of 30 million square kilometers, its human resources,
monde,
with its more than 60% of the world's
minière,
arable land, its mineral,
hydrique,
forests, water, and energy resources.
Oui, l'Afrique.
Yes.
Oui, nous avons l'Afrique des solutions, avec des gouvernements à la tâche, au quotidien, une jeunesse vibrante,
we have a vibrant and creative young people who innovate, who are entrepreneurial and who succeed. We have millions of men and women who work hard to feed, educate and care for their families, who invest, who create wealth.
Et génère des emplois.
And who generate jobs.
Cette Afrique des solutions souhaite engager avec tous ses partenaires des rapports réinventés qui transcendent le préjugé selon lequel qui n'est pas avec moi est contre moi. Nous voulons un multilatéralisme ouvert et respectueux de nos différences. Parce que le système des Nations Unies, né sur les cendres de la guerre, ne peut emporter l'adhésion de tous que sur la base d'idéaux partagés, un nom de valeurs locales érigées en normes universelles. C'est en collaborant dans le respect de nos différences que nous redonnerons force et vitalité à la raison d'être des Nations Unies, c'est-à-dire préserver les générations actuelles et futures du fléau de la guerre, promouvoir la cohabitation pacifique des peuples et favoriser le progrès en instaurant de meilleures conditions de vie pour tous.
For all.
Je souhaite plein succès aux travaux de la 77e session de l'Assemblée générale. Je vous remercie de votre aimable
attention.
On behalf of the Assembly, I wish to thank the President of the Republic of Senegal for the statement just made, and I request the protocol to escort His Excellency. And the Assembly will hear an address by His Excellency Gabriel Boric Font, President of the Republic of Chile. I request request the protocol to escort His Excellency. On behalf of the General Assembly, I have the honor to welcome His Excellency Gabriel Boric Font, President of the Republic of Chile, and to invite him to address the Assembly.
Muchísimas gracias.
Thank you very
señor
much.
Presidente, señor secretario
President,
general,
Secretary general,
estimadas y estimados jefes y jefas de Estado y de Gobierno, a todos los distinguidos invitados del día de hoy, es para mí un honor poder estar con ustedes en esta Asamblea General por primera vez. Vengo de Chile.
I come from Chile,
que es un hermoso país situado en el sur, en el extremo sur de América, entre la cordillera de los Andes, que es la columna de nuestro continente, y el majestuoso e imponente Océano Pacífico, un país que tiene una geografía diversa y paisajes conmovedores, en donde conviven juntos los cielos más claros
we have
con los mares más
tempestuosos, and the
el desierto
seas,
más seco,
the driest desert,
con ciudades hechas de lluvia.
Alongside cities
el pueblo
made
chileno,
of rain.
Como quizás algunos de ustedes conocen,
the people of
es
Chile,
trabajador
as
y solidario.
Know, is
gracias a su esfuerzo, hemos pasado en algo más de dos siglos
de
ser la colonia más pobre de España en América
a
ser un país independiente, libre, soberano y pujante. Un país con tremendas oportunidades que hoy está a las puertas de un desarrollo integral y que estamos trabajando que sea para todos, no para unos pocos. Un país que quiere cobre y litio para la electromovilidad. Un país con hidrógeno verde en desarrollo para proveer de energías limpias al mundo.
Energy,
un país con largas costas y áreas marinas protegidas para cuidar al medio ambiente. También con universidades de primer nivel para crear y compartir conocimientos. Vengo a decirles, estimados colegas, que Chile necesita al mundo y el mundo también necesita a Chile.
The world needs Chile too.
Pero como ustedes saben,
But
y ha quedado claro
aware,
en los discursos que nos han antecedido,
in,
vivimos en una época de profundas incertidumbres y sobresaltos, en la que es claro que no existen naciones, estando todas aquí representadas,
shocks,
que sean aisladas o inmunes a los sobresaltos, a lo que acontece a nivel global.
Or immune to global
y en esto
shocks
nuestro país,
events.
Por cierto, no es la excepción.
And Chile is no exception.
Así,
thus,
la guerra de agresión, la injusta
war,
guerra de agresión
Russia's unfair
desatada por Rusia en Ucrania,
aggression on Ukraine,
pueblo al que le expresamos nuestra solidaridad,
to which we express our
empujó
solidarity,
al alza el precio de los combustibles
fuel prices,
y causó desabastecimiento de granos y fertilizantes, causando un fuerte impacto en nuestra economía y de seguro,
our
también en las de muchos de ustedes.
And
también,
of many of your countries
y aunque
as well.
Cuesta a veces hablarlo.
Also,
la guerra comercial entre Estados Unidos y China, desatada en 2018 bajo la administración anterior de Trump,
China,
como también la pandemia, desestabilizaron la economía global y afectaron también la nuestra, como seguro también la de ustedes. En otra dimensión, la crisis humanitaria en Venezuela, producto de ya su prolongada crisis política,
which
ha generado un flujo migratorio que es inédito en nuestra región y en nuestro país, poniendo una presión tremenda sobre nuestras instituciones y nuestra sociedad.
Por
último, como seguramente muchos de ustedes están viviendo, la crisis climática afecta con particular fuerza a nuestro continente americano, y también en particular al Caribe y a los sistemas de vida de nuestra gente. En Chile, de hecho, cumplimos con 7 de los 9 criterios de vulnerabilidad establecidos por las Naciones Unidas, por nosotros mismos: áreas de borde costero de baja altura,
zonas áridas y semiáridas, zonas de bosque, propensión a los desastres naturales, sequía y desertificación, zonas urbanas con contaminación atmosférica y ecosistemas montañosos. Sin embargo, nuestro país, como seguramente muchos de los de ustedes, muchos de los del sur global, produce y es responsable de una parte mínima, en nuestro caso, el 0,24% de las emisiones globales del efecto invernadero. Mientras los países de las economías más grandes del G20, como nos recordaba el secretario general, produce el 80% de los gases con efecto invernadero. Como resulta evidente, en estos días ningún país, sea grande o pequeño, humilde o poderoso, puede pretender salvarse solo. Mientras preparaba en mi país este discurso, pensaba cómo en medio de tantos discursos de seguro muy interesantes contando la realidad específica de cada país, podía aportar con un pequeño grano de arena a la construcción de un mundo más justo posible.
With its small
y consciente
part
de que no soy quien para dar lecciones
and
sobre cada uno de los problemas que vive el mundo convulso en el que habitamos, pensé que contarles nuestra experiencia reciente como país puede servir a quien quiera escuchar para sacar vuestros propios aprendizajes. Chile vive actualmente un intenso proceso político. Hace casi 3 años,
Chile
vivimos hacer frente a una grave crisis política y
social.
Durante aquellos días,
una
gran mayoría de chilenas y chilenos manifestó su malestar frente a la desigualdad y los abusos, su indignación frente a las largas esperas para recibir atención en la salud pública, su hastío frente a las millonarias deudas por estudiar, su rechazo a las pensiones de miseria
at
the
million-dollar debts incurred as students, their refusal to accept miserly pensions, pensions that are a mere pittance after long years of work. In a few months, we will celebrate the 50 years since President Salvador Allende, who spoke to this very assembly, from this very podium, about the major social and political changes that Chile was going through at a time. Chile is a country that has, for a long time, sought the path towards dignity. And although during the democratic governments of the past 30 years, there was a remarkable decrease in poverty and progress on the social front, it is undeniable that the Chilean development model has kept a high concentration of wealth, leading us to be, and this is painful, one of the most unequal countries in the world.
En muchas de las naciones en vías de desarrollo,
this inequality
is
the case in many developing nations,
nuestro camino al desarrollo,
has obstructed
pero no solo
our path
eso,
towards development.
Es una amenaza latente
not
para la democracia.
That, it is an inherent
pues
threat to democracy
la sociedad misma,
because
destruye la cohesión social. Y por lo tanto,
breaks society
siendo un impedimento
apart. It destroys
social cohesion,
and it therefore hampers
understanding
and building a freer,
el
more fair future
que
together.
Chile
the social
en 2019, dejó perplejos a muchos observadores, algunos de ustedes, que preguntaban qué está pasando en este país, y también algunos actores de la vida nacional. Y es que a muchos
and
les llamó la atención
it
que un país
even
que ha logrado índices importantes
and
de crecimiento económico y de desarrollo humano que dan cuenta de importantes mejoras en la calidad de vida de su
and,
población
the fact is that
se haya visto enfrentado a la vez a una crisis tan profunda.
That a country that had such high indices
lo que ocurrió en mi patria
of economic
no fue casual,
growth and human
no fue
development, showing
sino la consecuencia
major
de
improvements in the quality of life of this population
should have faced
such a
deep
crisis.
Y afectando el
but
corazón
what
mismo
happened
de nuestra sociedad.
To to my country is no coincidence. It was the result of innumerable episodes of pain and postponement,
no se espere,
which simmered and then struck at the very heart of our society.
Por eso los quiero invitar,
and I want to point out that this can happen in your countries as well.
Juntos,
that is why
en la búsqueda de una mayor
I invite
justicia
you to
social,
plan ahead in the search
distribuir
for greater
de mejor manera
social
la riqueza
justice
y el poder
to better
debe ir de la mano,
distribute wealth
con un crecimiento
and
sostenible.
Power.
Y tengo la profunda convicción que espero que sea compartida de que aquello es posible y es urgente. Desgraciadamente, debo decirlo porque acá uno no puede solamente venir a hablar de las cosas buenas.
To talk about
este descontento
the
se manifestó también
en
graves episodios de violencia, como la inaceptable quema de estaciones de metro y la vandalización de centros cívicos. Y por otro lado, fuimos testigos de una represión descontrolada que terminó con muertes, heridos y más de 400 personas víctimas de trauma ocular producto de la acción del Estado, lo que constituye, desde el punto de vista de nuestro gobierno y de organismos internacionales de derechos humanos, en una grave violación a los derechos humanos que debe ser reparada y así lo será.
A severe violation of human rights,
fue,
which must
estimados
be
colegas, una larga historia
repaired.
De injusticia es la que se expresó en nuestro país en diciembre.
It must be made up for.
En octubre del 2019.
Of injustice,
pero también, y esto es lo lindo,
found
de cómo las historias son más largas
2019.
Que nosotros mismos,
also,
quienes hoy día ocupamos estos puestos. También fue la historia larga de la movilización ciudadana y las luchas sociales.
Esa que permitió
el retorno a la democracia, el reencuentro de los demócratas, como dijera el presidente Elwin a fines del siglo pasado, o la que en los albores del siglo XX permitió avanzar en derechos para los trabajadores y trabajadoras. En las manifestaciones del 2019 también estaban las mujeres del siglo pasado que avanzaron, pese a todo, hacia el derecho a voto femenino. Nos acompañaron el recuerdo de los obreros que lograron el derecho al descanso y los cobradores que lucharon y siguen luchando por una vivienda digna. Son todas esas memorias y luchas sociales las que estuvieron presentes. Y los valores detrás de este profundo malestar, la igualdad, la justicia, la libertad, no son ajenos a un reclamo que cada vez con más frecuencia vemos en el mundo y en esta
testera.
La protección y promoción de los derechos humanos en cualquier parte y por cualquier régimen, el trabajo decente, la protección social universal, la lucha contra la crisis climática son demandas universales que son el foco de nuestra agenda en común, liderada por nuestro secretario general, Antonio Guterres, y de los objetivos del desarrollo sostenible. Estimados líderes del mundo,
these are the values behind this deep
unrest. Para caminar en la solución pacífica y democrática de la crisis que vive nuestro país, fue un acuerdo importante entre las principales fuerzas políticas que permitió la elaboración de una ruta hacia la redacción de una nueva constitución, una que fuera capaz de sentar las bases de un nuevo contrato social.
The major political forces which made it possible to draw up a roadmap towards drafting a new constitution, one which made it possible to establish the basis of a new social contract, making a democratic response possible to the demands of the citizens. This road opened by Chilean society through protest and social struggle.
Consiste en lograr, como nunca antes en nuestra historia, una constitución democrática escrita con participación ciudadana, con participación de los pueblos indígenas y con paridad entre hombres y mujeres. Una constitución para todos y todas, pero también hecha por todos y todas. Hace algunas semanas, sin embargo, el trabajo realizado por la Convención Constitucional entre 2020
participation
entre 2021
of indigenous peoples and gender parity,
fue sometido a consulta ciudadana a través de un plebiscito en que los chilenos y chilenas participaron de nuevo masivamente, un 85% de participación. Y en este evento electoral, los ciudadanos rechazaron de manera clara la propuesta.
but this led to a clear rejection of the proposal, 62 against 38%.
Para construir thus, ese lugar today we are seeking new formulas
to build the meeting place for all Chileans.
Personal, my personal option fue de aprobar la propuesta que nos hacía la convención,
was to approve
pero el resultado fue en contrario.
For a new constitution.
Algunos
but the result was the opposite.
Han querido ver el resultado del plebiscito como una derrota del gobierno.
Want to see the result of the plebiscite
y
as
con
a defeat
toda humildad
for the
quiero hoy día decirles
and
a estas Naciones Unidas
I wish to tell
que
you
nunca
today
un gobierno puede sentirse derrotado cuando el pueblo
can
se pronuncia.
Never feel defeated
en democracia,
when the people speak.
La palabra popular es soberana y la guía para todo momento.
Popular is
pero
sovereign and is a guide for any government.
Pasado,
why am I telling you about this? Because unlike in the past,
fuego,
when differences
hoy,
in Chile were
las chilenas y los chilenos
settled through blood and fire,
de manera democrática
today
nuestros desafíos.
Chileans have agreed to
y
face
se los
our challenges
porque estoy
in a
seguro
democratic
que uno de los principales
fashion.
Desafíos de la humanidad hoy día
because I'm certain
es el de construir
that one of the major challenges
de verdad le hablen
for humanity
y le escuchen
today
a la gente.
Is that of building democracies that really talk to and listen
quienes
to citizens.
A esta asamblea, tenemos el
those
deber
who are
de
here
mejorar
at this assembly have the duty of improving our democracies.
Durante las multitudinarias jornadas de movilización,
during the long
la palabra
days
dignidad
of citizen mobilization, the word dignity
pues bien, este
was
mismo pueblo
often heard.
Se acaba de expresar dándonos una lección de democracia que tomamos. Chile le ha exigido a su democracia y a sus actores políticos estar a la altura de sus demandas y el desafío de hoy. Tenemos nosotros que estar también a la altura de ellas. Como gobierno,
hemos recogido
los resultados del reciente plebiscito con los ojos y el corazón bien abiertos.
With
open
eyes and hearts. We want to hear what the people is telling us. We trust their opinions. We trust their will. And there are things I want to share very quickly with you. The results are the expression of a citizenry that calls for change without putting its current achievements at risk. Citizens who want a better future
con estabilidad.
Built without creating new insecurities,
también,
a future
joven,
of change with stability.
Pocos años estaba en la calle,
as a young person who was on the street protesting not very long ago,
mucho más sencillo que
I can tell you that representing unrest is a lot easier than producing solutions. Those of us devoted to the demanding work of politics easily confuse our success as spokespeople for citizens' needs with our real ability to build a better future. The plebiscite results in Chile have taught us to be humble. Democracy must be humble. They made us realize that the building the Chile we dream of in building the Chile we dream of, no given sector has a recipe, rather
así
it is a dish made up of the best each one of us has to contribute. This is how we govern in the 21st century, mobilizing
no
capacity and skill in our societies, not trying to substitute them. As a president of Chile, I am convinced
Chile
that very soon Chile will have a constitution that will satisfy us and make us proud, one built in democracy that brings together the contributions of all sectors of society, able to reflect our aspirations of justice and liberty. Distinguished delegates, based on the humble history of my country, I can tell you with deep conviction that the path to face the problems affecting our societies is paved with more democracy, not less. With incentives for participation, not restrictions,
y por sobre todo,
with dialogue and not censorship, and above all, with respect for those who think differently, with inclusion of their points
no
of view and understanding
me
that having diverse
al abismo
opinions
que algunos pretenden
does not make us enemies.
Ante la legítima
I reject
de opiniones,
the abyss
y desde
that
Chile,
some try to
declaramos
open
nuestra voluntad de ser
when facing
de
the legitimate diversity of opinion.
Impiden.
And from Chile, we declare our will
diversas
of building bridges across
es
those gaps
y el aprendizaje que desde nuestro pequeño país queremos compartir con las naciones del mundo. Profundizar la democracia es un ejercicio permanente en el cual solo cabe perseverar y aprender cada uno de las experiencias del otro. Por eso, ya terminando, los invito a trabajar en conjunto para fortalecer la democracia en todos los espacios de cada país. En la relación entre nosotros, necesitamos una voz unida de América Latina, necesitamos más trabajo conjunto desde el sur global, necesitamos unas Naciones Unidas modernizadas, donde todos nos pongamos mismos objetivos.
Set ourselves the same objectives.
We commit ourselves from multilateralism to justice and peace anywhere and everywhere to take the actions needed. Para detener la injusta guerra de Rusia contra Ucrania y poner fin a todos los abusos de los poderosos en cualquier lugar del mundo, a movilizar nuestros esfuerzos para detener la violencia contra las mujeres, sea en Irán, en memoria de Mahsa Amini, muerta en manos de la policía esta semana, o en cualquier lugar del globo.
In the world,
a no naturalizar las permanentes violaciones a los derechos humanos contra el pueblo palestino, haciendo valer el derecho internacional y las resoluciones que año tras año esta misma asamblea establece que conduzcan a su derecho inalienable a establecer su propio Estado libre y soberano, como también a garantizar el legítimo derecho de Israel a vivir dentro de fronteras seguras e internacionalmente reconocidas, a seguir trabajando para contribuir a la liberación de los presos políticos en Nicaragua y trabajar para que en ningún lugar del mundo tener distintas ideas del gobierno de turno pueda terminar en persecución o vulneración de los derechos humanos. Estimados miembros de esta Asamblea, el mundo entero demanda cambios y quienes somos parte de las nuevas generaciones, aprendiendo de quienes nos antecedieron, tenemos el derecho y la responsabilidad de pensar y actuar para un futuro distinto.
To think and realize a different future. The citizens suffering the consequences of societies built on segregation and abuse call for the rights and for a safe life. This is a world that can only be achieved through more democracy. And this is a call which we must all respond to today. And in Chile, we are willing to cooperate anywhere in the world to that end. Thank you very much.
On behalf of the Assembly, I wish to thank the President of the Republic of Chile for the statement just made, and I request protocol to escort His Excellency. The Assembly will now hear an address by His Majesty King Abdullah II Ibn al-Hussein, King of the Hashemite Kingdom of Jordan. I request protocol to escort His Majesty. On behalf of the General Assembly, I have the honor to welcome His Majesty King Abdullah II, Ibn al-Hussein, King of the Hashemite Kingdom of Jordan, and to invite him to address the Assembly.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Mr. President, Mr. Secretary General, Your Excellencies, we meet today in this General Assembly as the alarm bells ring all around us. Numerous crises batter our world, crises that are increasingly interlocked. Regional conflicts with international impact, devastating climate change, pandemic disruptions, extremist violence, spiraling inflation, looming recession. And for all too many around the world, the growing reality of hunger. Developing countries have been hardest hit. Is this the future we will leave to the generations yet to come? We must deliver a different world, a world of expanded horizons, a more equitable world, sustainable economic growth, exciting new opportunities, and more and better jobs, and the inclusive peace for prosperity in which all people can thrive. To reach these goals, our countries
must unite behind effective collaborative action. The question now is, will we have the vision and determination to get the job done? Consider the climate crisis. No country can heal our injured earth alone. We need global partnerships that can create real change. And Jordan is part of these efforts. We have been building strong partnerships to manage and sustain vital water resources. And we see more opportunities to work with partners to preserve precious World Heritage sites and natural wonders. The unique Dead Sea, the sacred Jordan River, and the resilient coral reefs of the Gulf of Aqaba, which are all threatened by climate change. Food security is another global priority. Hundreds of millions of people go to bed hungry, and the numbers are rising. How can parents raise healthy children? How can students learn? How can workers do their best when they are hungry and hopeless? Since the beginning of the pandemic, and now with the crisis in Ukraine, global supply chains have been disrupted. Many well-off countries experience empty food shelves for the first time in living memory. They are discovering a truth that people in developing countries have known for a long time. For countries to thrive, affordable food must get to every family's table. On a global level, this demands collective measures to ensure fair access to affordable food and speed the movement of staples to countries in need. My friends, sustainable, inclusive economic growth has too often been a victim of global crises. But it can also be a defense that strengthens us to endure the storms. In my region, we are looking to build integrated partnerships that tap the capabilities and resources of each of our countries for the benefit of all. We see regional resilience pacts coming together to stimulate fresh opportunities and growth. Jordan has established multilateral partnerships with Egypt, Iraq, the UAE, Saudi Arabia, Bahrain, and others in the region to capitalize on these opportunities. Our country is a bridge for regional partnerships and cooperation, international crisis response, and humanitarian action. Jordan has always been a source of regional stability, as well as a refuge for those in need. In this context, let me say a word about refugees and the communities which host them. In 2012, I came before the 67th General Assembly and spoke for the first time about the Syrian refugee flow and its pressure on Jordan's scarce resources. At that point, 200,000 Syrians had sought refuge in our small country. Today, 10 years later, we host more than 1.3 million. Meeting the needs of these and other refugees is an international responsibility, and host countries look to the international community to honor its commitments. My friends, for decades, the Middle East has been synonymous with conflict and crisis. But we are hopeful that a newfound spirit of collaboration can and make our region an exemplar of resilience and integration. Though politics may sometimes fail our world, one absolute remains: always put people first. To keep hope alive for all peoples means rising above politics to ensure every individual's prosperity. Such efforts will be fruitless if they are exclusionary. Inclusion of the Palestinian people in regional economic projects should be an integral part of our efforts. In the Palestinian-Israeli conflict, peace continues to be elusive. Neither war nor diplomacy has held the answer to this historic tragedy. It is the people themselves, not politics and politicians, who will have to come together and push their leaders to resolve this. What would our world look like now if the conflict had been settled long ago? If walls had never gone up and people had been allowed to build bridges of cooperation instead? What if extremists had never been able to exploit the injustices of occupation? How many generations of youth could have grown up in the optimism of peace and progress? As we continue our efforts to achieve peace, we must not abandon refugees. This year, the General Assembly will vote on renewing UNRWA's mandate. The international community should send a strong message of support for the rights of Palestinian refugees, ensuring that Palestinian refugee children have schools to go to and access to appropriate medical care. My dear friends, a founding UN principle is the right to self-determination for all peoples. The Palestinian people, with their resilient national identity, cannot be denied this right. And the road forward is the two-state solution, in accordance with UN resolutions, a sovereign, viable, and independent Palestinian state, on the 4th of June, 1967 lines, with East Jerusalem as its capital, living side by side with Israel in peace and security and prosperity. Today, the future of Jerusalem is an urgent concern. The city is holy to billions of Muslims, Christians, and Jews around the world. Undermining Jerusalem's legal and historical status quo triggers global tensions and deepens religious divides. The holy city must not be a place for hatred and division. As custodians of Jerusalem's Muslim and Christian holy sites, we are committed to protecting their historical and legal status quo and to their safety and future. And as a Muslim leader, let me say clearly that we are committed to defending the rights, the precious heritage, and the historic identity of the Christian people of our region. Nowhere is that more important than in Jerusalem. Today, Christianity in the Holy City is under fire. The rights of churches in Jerusalem are threatened. This cannot continue. Christianity is vital to the past and present of our region and the Holy Land. It must remain an integral part of our future. Distinguished delegates, we can weather the most serious crises if we join together. Do let us here in this General Assembly honor our shared interests in a brighter future, a future of dignity and hope that brings new opportunities for all our peoples. And let us not ignore the alarm bells ringing around us. We must act. Thank you.
On behalf of the Assembly, I wish to thank the King of the Hashemite Kingdom of Jordan for the statement just made, and I request protocol to escort His Majesty. The Assembly will now hear an address by His Excellency Gustavo Petro Urrego, President of the Republic of Colombia. I request protocol to escort His Excellency. On behalf of the General Assembly, I have the honor to welcome His Excellency Gustavo Petro Urrego, President of the Republic of Colombia, and to invite him to address the Assembly.
Presidente de la Asamblea General de la Organización de Naciones Unidas, Chavarro Urochi. Secretario General de las Organizaciones de las Naciones Unidas, Antonio Guterres. Excelentísimos señores jefes de Estado y jefes de misiones acreditados ante la versión número 77 de la Asamblea General de las Naciones Unidas, Vicesecretaria General de la Organización de las Naciones Unidas, Amina Mohamed, a todas y todos. Vengo de uno de los tres países más bellos de la Tierra. Allí hay una explosión de vida.
There is an explosion
miles
of
de especies multicolores en los mares, en los cielos,
seas,
en las tierras.
Skies,
vengo
land,
de la tierra de las mariposas amarillas y de la magia. Allí en las montañas
there,
y valles de todos los verdes, no solo bajan las aguas abundantes,
green, not only
bajan
are
también
there abundant waters,
los torrentes
there
de la sangre.
Also floods of
vengo
blood.
De un país de belleza ensangrentada. Mi país no solo es bello,
country,
allí también
Colombia,
hay violencia.
Is not only beautiful, it is also violent.
No, ¿cómo puede conjugarse la violencia
how
con la muerte?
Violence,
¿cómo puede erupcionar la biodiversidad
side
de la vida
side?
Con las danzas de la muerte y el
horror?
¿Quién es el culpable de romper el encanto con el terror? ¿A quién o qué es el responsable de ahogar la vida en las decisiones rutinarias de la riqueza y del interés? ¿Quién nos lleva a la destrucción como nación y como pueblo? Mi país es bello porque tiene la selva amazónica, la del Chocó, las aguas, las cordilleras de los Andes y los océanos. Allí en esas selvas se emana oxígeno planetario y se absorbe el CO2 atmosférico. Una de esas plantas que absorbe el CO2 entre millones de especies es una de las más perseguidas de la Tierra. A como dé lugar, se busca su destrucción. Es una planta amazónica, es la planta de la coca.
It's a plant of the Amazon, the coca plant.
Como en un cruce de caminos paradójico, la selva que se intenta salvar es al mismo tiempo destruida. Para destruir la planta de coca, arrojan veneno, glifosato en masa, que corre por las aguas, detienen a los cultivadores y los encarcelan. Por destruir o poseer la hoja de la coca, mueren un millón de latinoamericanos asesinados y encarcelan a 2 millones de afros en América del Norte. Destruir la planta que mata, gritan desde el norte. Destruirla. Pero la planta no es sino una planta. Más de las
destroy the killer plant is a cry from the
north.
But the plant is just
a
one among many
destruir
of the millions that perish when
se convirtió en la consigna que siguen
fire breaks out in the jungle.
Negociantes.
Destroying the
no
jungle,
el
destroying the Amazon
de los científicos,
has become the
bautizando
catchword
la selva
which
como uno de los
and
business pilares
people
climáticos.
Follow.
Para las relaciones
the
del poder del mundo,
who
la selva y sus habitantes son los culpables de la plaga que las azota.
World,
a las relaciones de poder,
and its inhabitants
las azota
are those responsible
la adicción
for the plague
al dinero,
that afflicts them.
A perpetuarse,
the relations
al petróleo,
are plagued
a la cocaína y a las drogas más duras
money,
para poder anestesiarse más.
Addiction to oil,
nada más hipócrita
cocaine, and harder
que el discurso para salvar la selva. La selva se quema, señores, mientras ustedes hacen la guerra y juegan con ella. La selva,
there
el pilar climático del mundo,
the
desaparece con toda su vida. La gran esponja que absorbe el CO2 planetario se evapora. La selva salvadora es vista en mi país como el enemigo a derrotar, como la maleza a extinguir. El espacio de la coca y de los campesinos que la cultivan, porque no tienen más que cultivar, es demonizado. Para ustedes, mi país no les interesa, sino para arrojarle venenos a sus selvas, llevarse a sus hombres a la cárcel y arrojar a sus mujeres a la exclusión. No les interesa la educación del niño, sino matarle su selva y extraer el carbón y el petróleo de sus entrañas. La esponja que absorbe los venenos no sirve. Prefieren arrojarle más venenos a la atmósfera. Nosotros les servimos para excusar los vacíos y las soledades de su propia sociedad, que la llevan a vivir en medio de las burbujas de las drogas. Les ocultamos sus problemas que se niegan a reformar. Mejor es declararle la guerra a la selva, a sus plantas, a sus gentes, mientras dejan quemar las selvas, mientras hipócritas persiguen las plantas con venenos para ocultar los desastres de su propia sociedad. Nos piden más y más carbón, más y más petróleo para calmar la otra adicción, la del consumo, la del poder, la del dinero. ¿Qué es más venenoso para el ser humano, la cocaína o el carbón o el petróleo? El dictamen del poder ha ordenado que la cocaína es el veneno y debe ser perseguida. Así ella solo cause mínimas muertes por sobredosis y más por las mezclas que provoca su clandestinidad dictaminada. Pero en cambio, el carbón y el petróleo deben ser protegidos, así su uso pueda extinguir a toda la humanidad. Estas son las cosas del poder mundial. Cosas de la injusticia, cosas de la irracionalidad, porque el poder mundial se ha vuelto irracional. Ven en la exuberancia de la selva, en su vitalidad, lo lujurioso, lo pecaminoso, el origen culpable de la tristeza de sus sociedades, imbuidas en la profunda compulsión ilimitada de tener y de consumir. ¿Cómo ocultar la soledad del corazón en su sequedad en medio de sociedades sin afectos, competitivas hasta encarcelar el alma en la soledad, si no es echando la culpa a la planta, al hombre que la cultiva, a los secretos libertarios de la selva? Según el poder irracional del mundo, la culpa no es del mercado que recorta la existencia. La culpa es de la selva.
We conceal this by blaming
las cuentas bancarias se han vuelto ilimitadas. Los dineros guardados de los más poderosos de la tierra ya no podrán siquiera gastarse en el tiempo de los siglos. La tristeza de la existencia que produce esa artificial convocatoria a la competencia la llenan con ruido y con drogas. La adicción al dinero y al tener tiene otra cara. La adicción a las drogas en las personas que pierden la competencia de la carrera artificial en la que han transformado a la humanidad. La enfermedad de la soledad no se cura con el glifosato sobre las selvas. No es la selva la culpable. La culpable es su sociedad educada en el consumo sin fin, en la confusión estúpida entre consumo y felicidad que permite, eso sí, que los bolsillos del poder se llenen de dinero. La culpable de la adicción a las drogas no es la selva,
stupid confusion between consumption and happiness is what makes it possible for
de luz, the pockets of de razón the rich a su poder. To be filled. Prendan de nuevo las luces del
those
siglo.
Responsible for
40 años ha durado la guerra contra las drogas. Si no corregimos el rumbo y esta se prolonga otros 40 años, Estados Unidos verá morir de sobredosis a 2,800,000 jóvenes por fentanilo que no se produce en nuestra América Latina. Verá millones de afros norteamericanos ser apresados en sus cárceles privadas. El afro preso se convertirá en negocio de empresas carceleras. Morirán asesinados 1,000,000 de latinoamericanos más. Nos llenarán de sangre nuestras aguas y nuestros campos verdes. Verán morir el sueño de la democracia tanto en mi América como en la América anglosajona. La democracia morirá allí donde nació, en la gran Atenas occidental europea. Por ocultar la verdad, verán morir la selva y las democracias. La guerra contra las drogas ha fracasado. La lucha contra la crisis climática ha fracasado. Han aumentado los consumos mortales de drogas suaves, han pasado a las más duras. Se ha producido un genocidio en mi continente y en mi país han condenado a las cárceles a millones de personas para ocultar sus propias culpas sociales. Le han echado la culpa a la selva y sus plantas. Han llenado de sinrazón los discursos y las políticas. Yo les demando desde aquí, desde mi Latinoamérica herida, acabar con la irracional guerra contra las drogas. Disminuir el consumo de drogas no necesita de guerras, de armas. Necesita que todos construyamos una mejor sociedad, una sociedad más solidaria, más afectuosa, donde la intensidad de la vida salve de las adicciones y de las nuevas esclavitudes. Quieren menos drogas, piensen en menos ganancias y en más amor. Piensen en un ejercicio racional del poder. No toquen con sus venenos la belleza de mi patria. Ayúdennos sin hipocresías a salvar la selva amazónica para salvar la vida de la humanidad en el planeta. Ustedes reunieron los científicos y ellos hablaron con la razón, con matemáticas y modelos climatológicos. Dijeron que se acercaba el fin de la especie humana, que su tiempo ya no es de milenios, ni siquiera de siglos. La ciencia prendió la alarma y dejamos de escucharla. La guerra nos sirvió de excusa para no tomar las medidas necesarias. Cuando más se necesitaban las acciones, cuando los discursos ya no servían, cuando era indispensable depositar los dineros en los fondos para salvar la humanidad, cuando había que alejarse cuanto antes del carbón y del petróleo, se inventaron una guerra y otra. Invadieron Ucrania, pero también Irak y Libia y Siria. Invadieron en nombre del petróleo y del gas. Descubrieron en el siglo XXI la peor de sus adicciones, la adicción al dinero y al petróleo. Las guerras les han servido de excusa para no actuar contra la crisis climática. Las guerras les han mostrado cuán dependientes son de lo que acabará con la especie humana. Si observan que los pueblos se llenan de hambre y de sed y emigran por millones hacia el norte, hacia donde está el agua, entonces ustedes los encierran. Construyen muros, despliegan ametralladoras, les disparan.
los expulsan como si no fueran seres humanos, quintuplican la mentalidad de quien creó políticamente las cámaras de gas y los campos de concentración, reproducen a escala planetaria 1933, el día del gran triunfo del asalto a la razón. ¿Acaso no ven que la solución al gran éxodo desatado sobre sus países del norte es volver a que el agua llene los ríos y los campos se llenen de nutrientes? El desastre climático nos llena de virus que pululan, arrasándonos. Pero ustedes hacen negocios con las medicinas y convierten las vacunas en mercancías. Proponen que el mercado nos salvará de lo que el mismo mercado ha creado. El Frankenstein de la humanidad está en dejar actuar el mercado y la codicia sin planificar, rindiendo el cerebro y la razón, arrodillando la racionalidad humana a la codicia. ¿Para qué la guerra si lo que necesitamos es salvar la especie humana? ¿Para qué sirve la OTAN y los imperios si lo que viene es el fin de la inteligencia? El desastre climático matará centenares de millones de personas, y oigan bien, no lo produce el planeta, lo produce el capital. La causa del desastre climático es el capital. La lógica de relacionarnos para consumir cada vez más, para producir cada vez más, y para que algunos pocos ganen cada vez más. Es eso lo que produce el desastre climático. Le articularon a la lógica de la acumulación ampliada del capital los motores energéticos del carbón y del petróleo, y desataron el huracán, el cambio químico de la atmósfera, cada vez más profundo y mortífero. Ahora, en un mundo paralelo, la acumulación ampliada del capital es una acumulación ampliada de la muerte. Desde las tierras de la selva y la belleza, allí donde decidieron hacer de una planta selvática amazónica un enemigo, extraditar y encarcelar a sus cultivadores, les invito a detener la guerra y a detener el desastre climático. Aquí, en esta selva amazónica, hay un fracaso de la humanidad. Tras las hogueras que la queman, tras su envenenamiento, hay un fracaso integral civilizatorio de la humanidad. Detrás de la adicción a la cocaína y a las drogas, detrás de la adicción al petróleo y al carbón, está la verdadera adicción de esta fase de la historia humana. La adicción al poder irracional, a la ganancia y al dinero. He aquí la enorme maquinaria mortal que puede extinguir la humanidad. Les propongo, como presidente de uno de los países más hermosos de la tierra y de los más ensangrentados y violentados, acabar la guerra contra las drogas y todas las guerras, y permitir que nuestro pueblo pueda vivir en paz. Convoco a toda América Latina en este propósito. Convoco la voz de Latinoamérica a unirse para derrotar lo irracional que martiriza nuestro cuerpo. Los convoco a salvar la selva amazónica integralmente con los recursos que puedan destinarse mundialmente a la vida. Si no tienen la capacidad para financiar el fondo de la revitalización de la selva, si pesa más destinar el dinero a las armas que a la vida, entonces reduzcan la deuda externa para liberar nuestros propios espacios presupuestales y con ellos realizar la tarea de salvar la humanidad y la vida en el planeta. lo podemos hacer nosotros si ustedes los del norte no quieren. Solo cambien deuda por vida. Solo cambien deuda por naturaleza. Les propongo y los convoco en América Latina para ello.
I propose dialogar this para acabar la guerra.
No nos presionen para linderarnos en los campos de la guerra. Es la hora de la paz. Que los pueblos eslavos hablen entre sí. Que lo hagan los pueblos del mundo. La guerra es solo una trampa que acerca el fin de los tiempos en la gran orgía de la irracionalidad. Desde América Latina convocamos a Ucrania y Rusia a hacer la paz. Solo en paz podremos salvar la vida en esta nuestra tierra común. No hay paz total sin justicia social, económica y ambiental. Estamos en guerra también con el planeta. Sin paz con el planeta. No habrá paz entre las naciones. Sin justicia.
With no, no social justice, social. There is no gracias, social muy amable, peace. Thank you for your kind attention.
On behalf of the Assembly, I wish to thank the President of the Republic of Colombia for the statement just made, and I request protocol to escort His Excellency. The Assembly will hear an address by His Excellency Recep Tayyip Erdogan, President of the Republic of Turkey. I request protocol to escort His Excellency. On behalf of the General Assembly, I have the honor to welcome His Excellency Recep Tayyip Erdogan, President of the Republic of Turkey, and to invite him to address the Assembly.
Sayın Başkan, değerli devlet ve hükümet başkanları,
Mr. Chairman,
Sayın Genel Sekreter, kıymetli delegeler, sizleri şahsım ve milletim adına en kalbi duygularla, saygıyla selamlıyorum. Birleşmiş Milletler 77. Genel Kurulu'nun ülkelerimiz ve tüm insanlık için hayırlara vesile olmasını diliyorum. Genel Kurul Başkanlığı görevini üstlenen Sayın Kısaba Körösi'yi tebrik ediyorum. Genel Kurul toplantımız için belirlenen iç içe geçmiş sınamalara dönüştürücü çözümler için dönüm noktası temasını son derece isabetli buluyorum. Zira toplantımızı dünyamızın birden fazla tehditle eş zamanlı olarak baş etmeye çalıştığı kritik bir dönemde gerçekleştiriyoruz. Koronavirüs salgınıyla mücadelede aldığımız derslerin en başta geleni küresel sorunların çözümünde uluslararası dayanışmanın önemiydi. Türkiye olarak salgın sürecinde hiçbir ayrım gözetmeden 161 ülke ve 12 uluslararası kuruluşa destek sağladık. Yerli ve milli aşımız TÜRKOVAK'ı tüm insanlığın hizmetine sunduk. İklim değişikliğiyle mücadeleye verdiğimiz önemin göstergesi olarak Paris Anlaşması'nı geçtiğimiz yıl onayladık. Ulusal beyanımızla 2053 yılı için net sıfır emisyon hedefimizi ve yeşil kalkınma devrimimizi ilan ettik. Birleşmiş Milletler biyolojik çeşitliliğin korunması sözleşmesinin 16. Taraflar Konferansı'na ev sahipliği yaparak bu alanda da öncü rol oynamayı sürdüreceğiz. Salgının tedarik zincirlerinde yol açtığı aksaklıklar sebebiyle ağır darbe alan küresel ekonominin Rusya-Ukrayna savaşıyla birlikte yeni bir şok dalgasına da maruz kaldığını görüyoruz. Artan enerji, gıda ve ham madde fiyatlarının oluşturduğu enflasyon baskısı dünya çapında tüm ekonomileri ve sosyal refahı menfi yönde etkilemektedir. Gelişmeler enerji arz güvenliğinin önemini de çarpıcı bir şekilde yeniden gündeme taşımıştır. Türkiye olarak öteden beri enerji konusuna bir rekabet değil, işbirliği alanı olarak baktık. Kendi ihtiyacımız yanında bölgesel ve küresel enerji güvenliğini destekleyen pek çok projeyi hayata geçirdik. Bu adımların isabeti ve önemi son gelişmelerle bir kez daha anlaşıldı. Yaşanan süreç gıda güvenliğini de riske atmıştır. Maddi ve teknolojik imkanların en üst seviyeye ulaştığı 21. yüzyılda dünya nüfusunun halen 5'te 1'inin açlığın ve yoksulluğun pençesinde kıvranmasının izahı mümkün değildir. Dünya son gelişmelerle 2030'da sıfır açlık seviyesine ulaşmayı amaçlayan sürdürülebilir kalkınma hedeflerinden de uzaklaşmaya başlamıştır. İnsanlığın karşı karşıya kaldığı bu karanlık tabloyu umudun ışığıyla aydınlatabilmenin yegane yolu uluslararası işbirliği ve dayanışmayı hakkaniyetli ve adaletli bir yaklaşımla güçlendirmektir. Ortak kaderimizi etkileyen sınamalara karşı ortak gündemle harekete geçmemiz gereken bir döneme girdik. Türkiye olarak bu iradeyi salgın ve iklim değişikliği süreçleri yanında and during the crisis of climate change. Meydana getirdiği sarsıntılarla mücadelede de ortaya koyuyoruz. While we were fighting against Ukrayna'da the crisis created as a result of the Russian-Ukrainian conflict, ilk gününden bu yana conflict is savaşın kazananı, exceeding the seventh month adil bir threshold. Barışın ise kaybedeni olmayacağı düşüncesiyle hareket ettik. Bugün de yaşanan krizin çözümünde diyalog ve diplomasinin anahtar rolüne vurgu yapıyoruz. Bu anlayışta oynadığımız kolaylaştırıcı rol sayesinde tarafları önce Antalya diplomasi formunda, sonra İstanbul'da bir araya getirdik.
Sayın Genel Sekreter'le birlikte yürüttüğümüz yoğun çabalar neticesinde Ukrayna tahılının Karadeniz üzerinden dünyaya ulaşmasını temin ettik. Bu gelişmeyi sağlayan İstanbul Mutabakatı'nın ikinci ayı dolarken sevkiyatın her geçen gün ivme kazanmasını memnuniyetle izliyoruz. Tahıl arzının sürdürülmesinin sağlanmasında kritik öneme sahip bu mutabakat, Birleşmiş Milletler'in son yıllarda imza attığı en büyük başarılardan biridir. Dünyanın dört bir yanında uluslararası camiadan medet umanların Birleşmiş Milletler'e besledikleri güven bu başarıyla yeniden tazelenmiştir. İstanbul Mutabakatı taraflar açısından hayati önem arz eden meselelerde müzakerelerin sonuç verdiğini de ispatlamıştır. Benzer bir yaklaşım yine tüm insanlığın güvenliğini ilgilendiren Zaporijya nükleer santralindeki kriz konusunda da sergilenebilir. Son günlerde yeniden alevlenen savaşın Ukrayna'nın toprak bütünlüğü ve bağımsızlığı temelinde sonlandırılmasına yönelik gayretlerimizi artırarak sürdüreceğiz. Buradan uluslararası kuruluşları ve tüm ülkeleri Türkiye'nin kalıcı barışın tesisine yönelik çabalarına samimi destek vermeye çağırıyorum. Her iki tarafa da krizden onurlu çıkış imkanı verecek makul, adil ve uygulanabilir bir diplomatik çözümü beraberce bulmamız gerekiyor. Diğer yandan milyonlarca insanı mağdur eden tüm bu felaketler etkin çok taraflılığın Birleşmiş Milletler'de de vücut bulması için daha fazla çaba gösterme sorumluluğumuzu hepimize bir kez daha hatırlatmıştır. Birleşmiş Milletleri kapsayıcı vasfına yakışan the United Nations will have to be much more inclusive and be capable of creating certain solutions for a more fair world.
Bir teşkilat olarak yeniden yapılandırmamız şarttır. Bilhassa Güvenlik Konseyi'nin daha etkin, demokratik, şeffaf ve hesap verebilir bir yapı ve işleyişe kavuşturulması tüm insanlığın barış, adalet ve refah arayışında önemli bir dönüm noktası teşkil edecektir. Bu yöndeki ortak vazifemizi unutturmamak için dünya beşten büyüktür ve daha adil bir dünya mümkündür. Gerçeğinin altını her platformda en kuvvetli şekilde çizmeye devam edeceğiz. İnanç ve azimle yürüttüğümüz bu mücadeleye tüm üye ülkelerden destek beklediğimizi burada bir kez daha ifade etmek kıymetli delegeler, Türkiye'nin dış politikadaki vizyonu daima barış odaklı olmuştur. Bölgemizden başlayarak tüm dünyada sulh sükunun hakim kılınması için var gücümüzle çalışıyoruz. Birleşmiş Milletler bünyesinde yürüttüğümüz barış için arabuluculuk girişimimizle çatışmaların çözümü konusunda çaba harcıyoruz. Avrupa'dan Latin Amerika'ya ve Afrika'ya kadar farklı coğrafyalarda vuku bulan anlaşmazlıkların giderilmesinde yeri geldiğinde arabulucu, yeri geldiğinde kolaylaştırıcı olarak yapıcı rol üstleniyoruz. Çatışma ve ihtilafların çevrelediği bölgenin tam kalbinde, özellikle yer alan bir ülke sıfatıyla sorunların değil, çözümlerin bir parçası olmamızı sağlayacak inisiyatifler alıyoruz. Bu çerçevede Suriye krizine Güvenlik Konseyi'nin 22-54 sayılı kararı temelinde halkın meşru beklentileri doğrultusunda kalıcı bir çözümün bulunmasının önemini tekrar vurguluyorum. Çözümsüzlüğün sürmesi hem bölgemizin güvenlik ve istikrarını hem de Suriye'nin toprak bütünlüğünü giderek daha fazla tehdit etmektedir. Suriye'nin kuzeyindeki 4 milyonu aşkın sivil ülkemizin sağladığı güvenlik şemsiyesi ve uluslararası yardımlar sayesinde hayata tutunmaktadır. Kuzeybatı Suriye'deki yardım mekanizmasının temelini oluşturan kararın uzatılması için Güvenlik Konseyi mesuliyetini yerine getirmelidir. Ülkemize, güvenlik güçlerimize ve sivillere terör saldırıları gerçekleştiren bölücü gündemiyle Suriye'nin toprak bütünlüğünü tehdit eden PKK ve türevlerine karşı Türkiye'nin kayıtsız kalması beklenemez. Bu terör örgütünü isim değişiklikleri gibi ucuz kurnazlıklarla meşrulaştırmaya çalışanları bir an önce teröristleri silahlandırmaktan ve desteklemekten vazgeçmeye, hatalarından dönmeye davet ediyoruz. Terörizme karşı her türlü tedbiri almaya müstedir olduğumuzu, terör örgütlerine karşı gerekeni yapmaktan asla çekinmeyeceğimizi tekrar against terrorism, and we will always be very resolved Suriyeli in taking necessary measures in order to combat terrorism. Gönüllü, güvenli,
we are trying to do everything we can within our capability in a very sincere fashion to ensure that our Syrian brothers and sisters will be able to go back to their countries in a dignified, safe and a secure fashion.
Savaştan kaçan sivillerin
insani şartlarda hayatlarını sürdürebilmeleri için Suriye'nin çeşitli bölgelerinde 100,000 briket ev inşa ediyoruz.
Bunların önemli bir bölümünü tamamlayıp teslim ettik. Ayrıca yaklaşık 1 milyon Suriyelinin topraklarına dönmesini sağlayacak 200 bin konut inşası içinde
hazırlıklara
and
başladık.
We have started our preparations güvenli in order to build an additional 200,000 housing units so that 1 million Syrians will be able to go back to their homelands.
Hayata geçmesi için
insecure zones, in safe zones, in a total of 13 different centers
Suriye'de
and in rural areas, these projects will be completed
yerleri,
and we need the international support in order for that to be possible. Within this project, we need everybody to show serious and a committed solidarity and commitment. The irregular migration,
yola the refugee crisis, batırıp,
is not to be solved through
sınırlara,
leaving them to demise,
duvarlar örmekle, insanları to, toplama kamplarına doldurmakla çözülemez. Bu krizin çözümü insanı ve insan hayatını merkeze alan gayretlerden geçmektedir. Hal böyleyken Yunanistan'ın Ege Denizi ve Doğu Akdeniz'de göçmenlere yönelik zulümlerinin giderek arttığını görüyoruz. Türkiye olarak biz
yeni aylan bebeklerin
cesetleri
kıyıklara
babies
such as Aylan to be
Yunanistan
washed ashore.
Hukuksuz,
but at the same time, Greece is unfortunately pushing back these refugees in an illegal fashion, in a very tyrant fashion, turning the Aegean into a graveyard for
hafta,
refugees. Last week,
9 aylık,
a nine-month-old, a baby called Asım,
and
a four-year-old, Abdul Vahab,
Yunan sahil güvenlik güçlerinin botlarını batırması
lost
sonucu
lives
vefat
etmiştir. That the Greek
Avrupa'nın ve Birleşmiş Milletler kurumlarının insanlığa karşı suç teşkil eden bu acımasızlıklara artık bir dur demesinin vakti çoktan gelmiştir.
Stop,
diğer
enough,
bir komşu ülkemiz
Irak'ta
da huzurun ve istikrarın
another neighbor of us, which is Iraq,
we are trying
to invest tremendous efforts in order to make sure that peace and prosperity can be established there as well.
Temelinde. Siyasi
we want a political reconciliation to be established and a unity to
Irak'ta
be formed
refahın sürdürülebilir
within the
şekilde
of an Iraqi identity.
Ve terör örgütlerinin
for
istismarlarının
prosperity to be sustainably established in Iraq and to stop terrorist organizations abuses in Iraq, we have to move together. But of course there are terrorist organizations which are abusing the instability in Iraq
asla
and we will never stop fighting against the actions of the terrorist organizations
daha
against
de,
Turkey
deriving
from
gibi.
Iraq.
Terörizm belasıyla mücadeleyi terör örgütleri arasında ayrımı reddeden samimi ve etkin bir uluslararası işbirliğiyle kazanabiliriz. Hangi isim altında olursa olsun tüm terör örgütleriyle mücadelesini yıllardır devam ettiren Türkiye'nin müttefiklerinden ve dostlarından bu konuda samimi bir işbirliği ve dayanışma beklemek en tabii hakkımızdır. Terör örgütleri ve zalim rejimlerle ülkemizde işbirliği yaparak bölgenin güvenliğine, istikrarına, huzuruna, refahına katkıda bulunmak isteyecek herkesle çalışmaya hazırız. Kıymetli delegeler, dünyanın güvenliği bakımından üzerinde ısrarla durulması gereken yerlerden biri de Kuzey Afrika ve Doğu Akdeniz.
The Northern Africa and Eastern Mediterranean.
Bu çerçevede
and within that
Libya'nın
framework,
istikrar ve refahı başta komşuları olmak
is
üzere
to tüm
bölge için
stability and
kritik
önemdir. Libya, not only
Türkiye
for the
olarak
world, but also for the
Birleşmiş Milletler'in
and as
bu yöndeki
we
çabalarını
of the
destekliyoruz.
Of the
amacımız
we want
Libya halkının egemenliğini
the
birliğini,
sovereignty of the living
bütünlüğünü
people,
koruyarak,
the unity,
hak ettiği
the
refah
integrity,
düzeyine erişmesini
making sure that
sağlamak.
They reach the much desired
Libya'da
level of
adil ve muteber bir seçimin yapılarak,
a fair and
meşruiyetini halktan alan güçlü bir hükümetin iş başına
and
gelmesi hepimizin katkıda bulunacağı temel hedef olmalıdır. Orta Doğu coğrafyasında kalıcı barış, ve istikrarın tesisi açısından sona erdirilmesini gerekli gördüğümüz İsrail-Filistin ihtilafında iki devletli çözüm vizyonuna güçlü destek veriyoruz. Kudüs'ün tarihi ve kültürel kimliğiyle
we have to preserve the historical and cultural identity of Jerusalem, and we have to respect Harami
Sharif.
And we have to stop the illegal settlements in the occupied regions through establishing a security for the lives and the commodities of the Palestinians. We have to establish a permanent and a fair solution
bağımsız ve egemen Filistin devletinin kurulması dışında bir ihtimal yok. Türkiye olarak İsrail ile ilişkilerimizi hem kendimizin hem bu ülkenin hem Filistin halkının hem de bölgenin huzuru, istikrarı, geleceği için birleştirmeyi sürdürmekte kararlıyız. Bu süreçte Birleşmiş Milletler Filistinli mültecilere yardım ajansının kurumsal ve mali kapasitesinin geliştirilmesi, Filistinli mazlumlara sahip çıkılması, uluslararası toplumun sorumluluğu, Türkiye, İran'la yürütülen kapsamlı ortak eylem planının küresel ve bölgesel istikrar için taşıdığı önemi daima vurgulamış bir ülkedir. İran'ın nükleer programına ilişkin hususların diplomasi ve diyalog yoluyla çözümüne yönelik görüşmelerin en kısa sürede sonuçlandırılarak uygulamaya geçirilmesini bekliyoruz. Azerbaycan'ın işgal altındaki topraklarını kurtarması, Güney Kafkasya'da kalıcı barışın ve istikrarın temini konusunda tarihi bir fırsat penceresi
a historical opportunity to Türkiye make sure that a permanent Azerbaycan peace and stability Ermenistan can be established in southern Caucasia. As Turkey, we have been very supportive of the process going on between Azerbaijan and Armenistan, and we have taken significant steps forward in order to make the utmost use of this opportunity that avails itself. Recent conflicts had shed an obscure shadow upon these positive developments, but we believe still that a permanent
Azerbaycanlı kardeşlerimizin haklarını ve geleceklerini inşa konusunda verdikleri mücadelede daima yanlarında olmayı sürdüreceğiz. Ülkemizi de yakından ilgilendiren bölgedeki ulaştırma bağlantılarının en kısa sürede açılması ise herkesin refahına katkı sağlayacak bir gelişme olacak. Neredeyse yarım asırdır işgal, çatışma, terörizm, sefalet gibi sorunlarla boğuşan Afganistan yine bir sınamadan geçmiştir. Ülkedeki geçici hükümetin temel insan haklarının korunması doğrultusunda atacağı adımlar umut verici gelişmelerin önünü açabilir. Türkiye bu zor günlerinde Afgan kardeşlerini desteklemeyi sürdürecek. Hindistan ve Pakistan'ın bağımsızlıklarını kazanmalarının üzerinden geçen 75 yıla rağmen aralarında hala güçlü bir barış ve işbirliği tesis edilememiş olmasından 75 years ago, dileğimiz, they still haven't established peace Keşmir'de and solidarity adil ve kalıcı barış between one another. Ve huzura and this is ulaşılmasıdır. Yakın tarihte yaşanan bir sel felaketi sebebiyle son derece sıkıntılı günler geçiren Pakistan halkına tekrar geçmiş olsun diyoruz. Afetin ardından başlattığımız insani yardım çalışmalarımızı aralıksız sürdürüyoruz. Uluslararası toplumunda Pakistan halkına içinden geçtikleri usancılı dönemde destek vermesini bekliyoruz. Rohingya Müslümanlarının ana vatanlarına güvenli, gönüllü, onurlu ve kalıcı şekilde geri dönüşleri için desteğimiz devam ediyor. Çin'in toprak bütünlüğüne, tek Çin anlayışına ve
ve egemenlik haklarına kesinlikle halel getirmeyecek şekilde Müslüman Uygur Türklerinin temel hak ve özgürlüklerinin korunması hususunda hassasiyet gösteriyoruz. Balkanlarda barış ve istikrarın güçlendirilmesi, anlaşmazlıkların diyalog yoluyla çözümü için ikili ve çok taraflı platformlarda yoğun gayret gösteriyoruz. Bu anlayışla Eylül başında Bosna Hersek, Sırbistan ve Hırvatistan'ı kapsayan bir bölge turu gerçekleştirdik. Bosna Hersek'teki seçimlerin sorunsuz şekilde yapılması ile Belgrad, Priştine diyalog sürecinde ilerleme sağlanması bölgenin istikrarına katkı verecek. Türkiye olarak Ege Denizi'nde ve Doğu Akdeniz'deki tüm meselelerin iyi komşuluk ilişkileri çerçevesinde ve uluslararası hukuka uygun olarak çözülmesini istiyoruz. Bölgede ülkemizde asla denk olmayan siyasi ve askeri seviyesine rağmen güç gösterisi peşinde koşanlar kendilerini komik duruma düşürmek.
Those countries who are going after adventures in our region are making themselves feel funny, which are no equivalent to us at all.
Saygı
in the Eastern Mediterranean, Yunanistan'dan peace and stability depends on respecting the rights of all the parties involved. We expect Greece to leave escalation and provocation policies to one side and respond to our calls for cooperation and solidarity. We believe that the Eastern Mediterranean Conference that we had recommended previously will serve this very purpose. Our interlocutors, unfortunately, had never taken a positive step forward
ve diyalogdan kimin de gerilimden yana olduğunu göstermektedir. Türkiye, Ege ve Doğu Akdeniz'deki haklarını sonuna kadar savunurken kendi siyasi hesapları uğruna gerginlik stratejisi izleyenlerin oyunlarına da asla gelmeyecek. Kıbrıs meselesinde de adil, kalıcı ve sürdürülebilir bir çözüme ulaşılabilmesi için Kuzey Kıbrıs Türk Cumhuriyeti ile birlikte hep iyi niyetli ve yapıcı çaba sergiledi. Esasen gerçekleri görmek isteyen herkes bugün adada iki ayrı devlet, iki ayrı halk olduğunu bilmektedir. Kıbrıs Türk halkının egemen eşitlik ve eşit uluslararası statü haklarının tescil edilmesi adadaki çözümün anahtarıdır. Uluslararası toplumun Birleşmiş Milletler prensipleriyle çelişir şekilde ambargolarla dünyadan koparılmaya çalışılan Kıbrıs Türklerine yönelik zulme son vermeye bir an önce Kuzey Kıbrıs Türk Cumhuriyeti'ni resmen tanımaya davet ediyor. Avrupa Birliği üyesi Yunanistan, Ege Denizi'ndeki düzensiz göçmenlere uyguladığı insanlık dışı geri itmeler yanında Müslüman Türk azınlığa karşı da hukuki yükümlülüklerini ihlal eden ayrımcı ve baskıcı politikalar izlemektedir. Temennimiz and there are also imposing certain policies upon the Turkish minorities which are of Muslim descent, Avrupa Birliği başta olmak üzere neglecting uluslararası kuruluşlarında yapılan insanlık dışı
so what we want to see is to see Greece finalizing these efforts and
kıymetli
delegeler the European Union
küresel ve bölgesel planda
be more considerate instead of turning a blind eye towards these violations. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, every challenge that we experience on a global and a regional fashion, we see that solidarity between Turkey and the EU is very much significant. Turkey is celebrating the 70th anniversary of joining NATO. We are a very strong ally of NATO. We have diplomatic initiatives and we have military capabilities that are contributing to the security of the Europe and the Atlantic.
İstikrar ve refahına katkılarımız sürerken en batıdaki Asyalı olarak da yeniden Asya girişimiyle bu kıtada aynı amaçla çalışıyoruz.
Asian, on the western coast of Europe, and we are leading certain initiatives such as Asia Again in order to become much more proactive.
We are trying to
establish closer contacts and solidarity with the African countries as a result of the recent global initiatives that we have taken up. Within that framework, between 16th and 18th of December 2021, with the large participation of our African friends, we have managed to hold the third partnership, Turkey and Africa Partnership Summit in Istanbul.
Ve refah yolculuğuna Turkey eşit bir ortak olarak eşlik etme iradesini her fırsatta göstermektedir. Latin Amerika'yla da karşılıklı saygı temelinde güçlenen işbirliğimizi ikili planda ve bölgesel teşkilatlarda kurumsal düzeyde artırmaya devam etme kararlılığındayız. Uluslararası sistemin çeşitli krizlerle sarsıldığı bu dönemde insanlığı bekleyen en büyük tehlikelerden birinde birlikte yaşama iradesinin kaybedilmesi olduğunu özellikle vurgulamak
istiyorum.
Irkçı, ayrımcı, yabancı ve İslam düşmanı tutumlarda son yıllarda yaşanan artışlardan derin endişe duyuyoruz. Bu tür süren Yeni Zelanda'da Müslümanlara karşı gerçekleştirilen terör saldırısının yıl dönümü olan 15 Mart tarihinin
We had launched an appeal over
İslam
this platform to call that March 15th will be called a day for fight against Islamophobia Day
as a result of the attack that took place against the Muslims in New Zealand. And we would like to underline that appeal again.
First, within the OIC and within the General Assembly of the United Nations, we have taken certain decisions in order for that day to be declared as a fight against Islamophobia Day. We hope and pray that it will be a possibility. We hope and pray that this day will be declared as a day to fight Islamophobia. As I have previously stated, Islamophobia is equal to anti-Semitism, and it is a crime against humanity. And with these thoughts, I hope and pray that the 77th of the General Assembly of the United Nations will be able to accomplish the target, which will respond to the expectations and the aspirations of the entire human race. I hope and pray that you will stay in health and stay in peace. I would like to salute you all with love and respect on behalf of my personal self and on behalf of my nation. Thank you.
On behalf of the Assembly, I wish to thank the President of the Republic of Turkey for the statement just made, and I request the protocol to escort His Excellency. Before proceeding, may I kindly ask delegations to remember that the time slots, time limits allotted for a national intervention is 15 minutes. Delegations will be highly appreciated to stick to these time limits. The Assembly will hear an address by His Excellency Sadir Japarov, President of the Kyrgyz Republic. I request the protocol to escort His Excellency. On behalf of the Assembly, I wish to thank the President and have the honor to welcome His Excellency Sadir Japarov, President of the Kyrgyz Republic, and to invite him to address the Assembly.
Dear Mr. President, distinguished heads of delegations, dear Secretary General, I would like to sincerely congratulate the Brotherly Hungary on the election of its High Representative as the President of the 77th Session of the United Nations General Assembly. I wish the Honorable Çaba Kureshi every success in such an important international position.
Kırgız Respublikası sizlere her tarafta olduğu gösterdiği daim dayarekendigin bildiremin. Uşunu menen birge Birikken Uluttar Uyumunun Başkan Assambleyasının Murunku sesiyasının törögası құрматты Абдулла Шахид Мырзаға дүниелік қоғамшылық үшін ор мезгінде талықпай еңгектенгендіге, ошондой эле біздің өлкөнүн ел аралық демилгелерін дайыма колдогондугу үшін ыраазычылык билдиремин. Урматту айымдар жана мырзалар, мындан 77 жыл мурда адамзаттын тарыхындагы эң айыгышкан экинчи дүйнөлүк согуш аяктагандан кийин Бириккен улуттар уюму түзүлгөн. Балким 1945 жылы Сан-Франциско шаарында уюмду түзүү боюнча эл аралык келишимге кол койгон Бириккен улуттар уюмунун негиздөөчү мамлекеттери согуштар, кыйроолор, ачарчылык, азап тозоктор бир отоло токтойт деген ойдо болушкандыр. Мен андай деп ойлобойм.
I don't think so.
Эгерде талаш тартыштарды жана пикир келишпестиктерди компромисстин жана ак ниеттүүлүктүн маанайында чечүү зарыл деген өз ара түшүнүшүү болсо, анда ар дайым ийгиликке жетишсе болот. Албетте, Бириккен улуттар уюмунун тарыхында көптөгөн маанилүү жеңиштер жана ийгиликтер болду. Чыр чатактар жана кагылышуулар дүйнөнүн ар кайсы аймагында ар кандай даражадагы ургаалдуулук менен болгонуна карабастан, Бириккен улуттар уюму моралдык авторитет болуп, тынчтыкты жана коопсуздукту сактоодо, адамдардын керектөөлөрүн жана муктаждыктарын камсыз кылууда маанилүү бириктирүүчү ролду ойноду. Тынчтыкта жашоонун фундаменталдуу негиздери бузулат жана чоң согуш болушу мүмкүн деген коркунучтардан улам дүйнөлүк коомчулукта тынчсыздануу пайда болуп, дүйнөдөгү геосаясий кырдаал болуп көрбөгөндөй татаалдашкан шартта эл аралык тынчтыкты жана коопсуздукту сактоо ушул максатты көздөп тынчтыкка каршы коркунучтарды болтургоо жана жоюу, агрессияны же тынчтыкты бузган башка аракеттерди токтотуу боюнча натыйжалуу жамааттык чараларды көрүү, эл аралык талаш тартыштарды же тынчтыкты бузушу мүмкүн болгон кырдаалдарды адилеттүүлүктүн жана эл аралык укуктун принциптерине ылайык тынчтык жолу менен жөнгө салуу же чечүү, элдердин тең укуктуулук жана өзүн таануу принцибин урматтоонун негизинде улуттар арасында достук мамилелерди өнүктүрүү деп Бириккен улуттар уюмунун уставында жазылган бийик максаттарды жана милдеттерди баарыбыз эстен чыгарбай, өзгөчө маани берип милдеттерди аткарышыбыз керек. Биздин өлкө мамлекеттүүлүктү түзгөндөн баштап эле Бириккен улуттар уюмунун уставын ырааттуу жана катуу сактап, өзүбүздүн милдеттерибизди ак ниет аткарып келүүдөбүз. Ушул жылдын март айында өлкөбүздүн Бириккен улуттар уюмуна киргенине туура 30 жыл болду. Ал эми Кыргыз Республикасынын эгемендүүлүгүнүн 31 жылдыгын жакында эле кечээ жакында эле 31 августта белгиледик. Биз дайыма эл аралык талаш тартыштарды тынчтык жолу менен чечүүгө умтулабыз. Биз эл аралык мамилелерде кандайдыр бир мамлекеттин аймактык бүтүндүгүнө же саясий көз карамсыздыгына каршы күч колдонуудан же коркунуч келтирүүдөн дайыма алыспыз. Өлкөбүздүн басып өткөн татаал жолуна көз чаптырып, Кыргызстандын көз карандысыз жана эгемендүү мамлекет, эл аралык коомчулуктун тең укуктуу жана жоопкерчиликтүү мүчөсү катары калыптанышына Бириккен улуттар уюмунун кошкон көп кырдуу салымын абдан жогору баалайбыз. Саясий, коомдук жана жарандык институттарды калыптандырууда, демократияны чыңдоодо, рыноктук экономиканы өнүктүрүүдө Бириккен улуттар уюмунун колдоосун жана жардамын элибиз эч качан унутпайт. Өзүнүн эгемен мамлекетин түзүү жөнүндө кыргыз элинин кылымдардан бери келе жаткан асыл максатын ишке ашырууга чын ыкластан жана жан дили менен жардам берген Бириккен улуттар уюмунун системасынын баардык жетекчилерине жана кызматкерлерине айкөл элибиздин жана жеке өзүмдүн атымдан терең ыраазычылык билдирем. Силерге чоң рахмат. Урматтуу төрага мырза, учурдан пайдаланып, ушул бийик трибунадан
I would like to present to the world community from this high tribune the actual situation that is developing on the southern borders of our country, taking into account the latest events related to the another aggravation of situation on the Kyrgyz-Tajik border. First, let me briefly touch on the history. The collapse of the Soviet Union in December 1991 paved the way for territorial disputes and border problems. Some of them have not been regulated to this day. If there were more than 20 disputed areas along the entire perimeter of the Soviet-Chinese border, five of them were in Kyrgyzstan. I want to proudly remind the world community that we have successfully completed issues of border regulation, first with the Republic of China in 1996, and jointly with the Republic of Kazakhstan at the point of intersection of the state borders of three countries in 1999. Then with the Republic of Kazakhstan in 2017. We have now practically completed our joint work and are about to sign the agreement on the state border with the Republic of Uzbekistan.
Коңшу өлкө менен мамлекеттик чегарабыз тынчтыктын, ынак
коңшулуктун, достуктун жана өз ара пайдалуу кызматташтыктын чегарасына айлангандыгын зор кубаныч менен баса белгилеп кетем. And mutually beneficial cooperation.
Тажикстан Республикасы менен болгон мамилебиз боюнча
relations with the Republic of Tajikistan, I would like to note the following. Our two close neighboring peoples have been living side by side for a long time. We are united by common values, culture, traditions, and customs. We share the same faith. Our people are intertwined by family ties. Our legendary father Manas was married to a Tajik princess.
Советтер Союзу юридикалык жактан 1991 жылдын 21 декабрда Казакстан Республикасынын Алматы шаарында тараган.
Мында
11 көз карандысыз мамлекеттин башчылары көз карандысыз мамлекеттер шериктигин түзүү жөнүндө Алматы декларациясы кабыл алынган.
States adopted the Almaty Declaration on the creation of the Commonwealth of Independent
States. The declaration stated that independent states recognize
and respect each other's territorial integrity and the inviolability of existing borders. They indicate that strengthening of relation of friendship, good neighborliness, and mutual beneficial cooperation, which have historical roots, meets the fundamental interest of people and serve the cause for peace and security. It is written that the countries sense their responsibility to maintain civil peace and international harmony. This legal document was signed by the presidents of 11 states, 11 presidents of 11 CIS member states, including the Republic of Tajikistan. This principle was confirmed by the President of Tajikistan, Rahmon, in Moscow Declaration of the CIS on respect for sovereignty, territorial integrity and immunity of borders of the state parties of the Commonwealth of Independent States, dated April 15, 1994. He signed it and agreed. It is a pity that he is deviating from this principle now.
Тажикстандагы кандуу жарандык согуш аяктагандан кийин
1998 жылы биринчи расмий иш сапарын Кыргыз Республикасына жасаган.
Кийинчерээк Кыргыз Республикасы менен Тажикстан Республикасынын ортосундагы эки тараптуу мамлекеттер аралык эки келишим 1996 жылдын 12 июлундагы мамлекеттер аралык мамилелердин негиздери жөнүндө келишим жана 2004 жылдын 26 майындагы ынак коңшулук жана өнөктөштүк мамилелери жөнүндөгү келишим түзүлгөн. Эки келишим тең дүйшөмбү шаарында. Урматтуу төрага мырза,
dear Mr. President,
эки мамлекеттин ортосундагы чегара маселелерин жөнгө салуу боюнча иш башталгандан тартып, Кыргыз тарап дайыма өзүнө алган эл аралык милдеттенмелерге, анын ичинде эки тараптуу милдеттенмелерге ылайык иш жүргүзүп, өз ара пайдалуу компромисстерди сунуштоого аракет кылып, конструктивдүү маанайдагы сүйлөшүүлөрдү жүргүзүп келебиз. Belgileye geçsem,
I would like to note that in April 2021, the armed forces of Tajikistan launched an unjustified and provoked large-scale aggression against the territory of the Kyrgyz Republic, killing 36 citizens and causing serious material damage. Although my decision to meet the president of the Republic of Tajikistan in Dushanbe was heavily criticized by the Kyrgyz people who demanded that I meet in a natural location. Nonetheless, I flew to Dushanbe and met with Mr. President Rahmon in June last year to try and find a mutually beneficial solution to the border issues. For the sake of my people, I am ready to spend not only 10 hours on negotiations as on that day, but to spend as much time as possible to solve this issue once and for all. Of course, whatever the solution,
Alemi Uşul Jıldın, 14-15 yana 16 sentyabrında Kırgızstan'dın düştüğünde masştabtu askerlik kağılışı bolgondugun teren kaygıruu menen
kabarlayım.
Murda süyleşülgön bardık makuldaşuularga karabay, Tajik tarap, Kırgız-Tajik mamlekettik çegarasının bardık perimetri boyunca çegaralık jana jaranlık obyektilerge çabuul jasadı. 140 minge jakın jaranıbız çegaraga jakın kalktuu konuştardan evakuasiyalandı. Alarga kerektüü jardamdar körsötülüp jatat. Şuga baylanıştuu tilektештик jana moraldık koldoo körsötkөндүгү үчүн Biriken
in this regard, I would like to express my sincere gratitude to the U.S. system, our friendship, our friends and partners for their solidarity and support. Great material damage was caused to civilian and military facilities, houses, administrative buildings, schools, frontier posts. Be what may, any material damage can be restored. However, you cannot return the lives of our citizens who were fired upon and brave defenders who died fighting for their homeland and sacrificed their lives. We will never forget the bravery of our
Tajikistan tarafının hiç kanday sebepsiz ele jasagan ushunday kuraldu agressiyalık tüzüü karalık aksiyaları bizdi öte kapaglıuda. Antkeni bizdin ölkölörünün ortosunda el aralık kelişimder jana milletlenmeler tüzülgön
bolcho.
Pacta sunt servanda.
Pacta sunt servanda.
Kelişimder saktalışı gerek deyip latın makalına aytılat. Biz Tajik koşunağız menen kanday gana formatta bolbosun, el aralık erejelerinin negizinde, sivilizasyalu, yuridikalık joldor menen süyleşü prosesini ulantmaya
dayarbız.
Koŋşubuzdun mıyzamga karşı sokku hareketlerinin kesepetinen, bizdin işenimimiz solgundap ketkendigini eske alıp, biz süyleşülördü ulantuğa el aralık, anın içinde Birikken Uluktar Uyumu, Evropa Kızmattaştık Jana Koopsuzluk Uyumu, Jamaattık Koopsuzluk Kızmattaştık Uyumu siyaktuu uyumdardın ortomçuluğuna da dayarbız. Bizde Tajik taraptın ötkön jıldarda jana keçeyeki jasagan hukukka karşı birincilerden bolup kol salgan iş hareketlerinin dokumentleştirilgen dalilleri bar. Biz hiç kaçan birinci olup kol salgan emespiz, jana kol salbaybız.
Ar daim kural koldoğudan
alıs bolu hareket jasap kelebiz, jana hiç kaçan kuralsız jay turgundardı
atpaybız. Bizge daima Tajik tarafının
jasagan agresiyasına adekvattuu joop kaytaruu menen gana çektelip
jatabız.
Ushuga baylanıştuu tömönkülördü basa
belirleyin.
Kırgız tarap bötön bireönün yerine göz
artpaybız,
бирок bir da santimetre jerimizdi
bireögö bermeyiz.
Biz bardık çegara jana çarba maselelerdi süyleşüler menen gana çeçilişi gerek деп эсептейбиз.
Bugünkü çegaraga
jakın rayondordo koopsuzlukku jana
tınçkuluktu kamsızlığı
boyunca keçiktirilgis çaralardı körüü. Жергиликтүү халк арасында чыңалууну күчөтүүгө багытталган аракеттерге бөгөт
коюу.
Эки мамлекеттин ортосундагы ишенимди бекемдөө маселелери абдан маанилүү
болуп турат. Ошондуктан биз чек ара
тилкелерибизди тез арада такташып бүтүүгө
дайындайбыз. Урматтуу
төрага мырза, жалпы Бириккен Улуттар Уюмунун проблематикасына токтолуп, төмөнкүлөрдү белгилегим келет.
This year, as half of the implementation period of the UN Sustainable Development Goals until 2030 has passed, and we can now objectively look at the real situation we have at hand. The adoption of the SDGs in 2015 under the motto "Leave no one behind" was a bright example of the constructive negotiation capacity of the world community in the interests of all of us and subsequent generations. Meanwhile, it has already become obvious that due to objective circumstances, including due to the coronavirus pandemic, the implementation of the Sustainable Development Goals in developing countries, including our country, has slowed down. And without adequate international funding, many of them may not even achieve the critical indicators of the SDGs. On my part, I want to confirm the firm commitment of the Kyrgyz Republic to the SDGs and their gradual implementation, taking into account the national capacity. I believe that our country's own potential should be the main source and engine for sustainable development. For this purpose, our efforts are aimed at achieving an accelerated and qualitative growth of the economy, including through mutually beneficial regional and international trade and investment cooperation. For example, Kyrgyzstan actively participates in Евразия экономикалық бірлігінің жаңа Қытай Ел Республикасының бір алқақ бір жол демілгесінің алқағында активті қатысуда. Біз барлық қызықтар тараптарменен ішкердік қызматташуға жаңа инвестициялық
On my part, I want to confirm the firm commitment of the Kyrgyz Republic to the SDGs and their gradual implementation, taking into account national capacity. I believe that our country's own potential should be the main source and engine of sustainable development. For the purpose, accelerated, for example,
жүргүзүлүп жаткан саясаттын алкагында жашыл санариптик жана креативдүү экономиканы артыкчылыктуу көңүл
бурулган. Өлкөдө жашыл экономика локомотиви болгон гидроэнергетика тармагы активдүү өнүгүүдө
чакан жана орто кесттер пайдаланууга киргизилүүдө. Эң ири камбар ата кесим курууга биздин ынак коңшуларыбыз Казакстан
in the construction of the largest hydroelectric power station, because this will strengthen the energy security and optimize the use of our water resources in the region. In general, I want to note the spirit of unity, understanding, trust and support, which was demonstrated in the city of Cholpon Ata 2 months ago when the forces Чолпон Ата шаарындагы 21-нчи кылымда борбордук Азияны өнүктүрүү максатында достук, ынак коңшулук жана кызматташтык жөнүндө келишимге тараптардын кол коюшу мамлекеттер аралык алакабыздын жаңы барагын ачат деп ишенем. Биз ушул форматтан иштейбиз. Урматтуу башкы катчы, урматтуу
Dear Secretary General, dear ladies and gentlemen, at the end of my speech,
I want to assure you that Kyrgyzstan fully supports the UN as the only universal structure authorized by all of us, the member states of the UN, to solve the challenges faced by humanity.
Бириккен Улуттар Уюму өзүнүн бардык функцияларын тийиштүү түрдө аткара берет жана мүчө мамлекеттерге маанилүү глобалдык көйгөйлөрдү чечүүдө жана терс көрүнүштөрдү жеңүүдө көмөк көрсөтөт деп
ишенем.
Ушул татаал эл аралык мезгилде бардык мүчө мамлекеттерди уюмга тилектештик жана саясий колдоо
and solidarity to the organization in this difficult international time. Dear Mr. President, dear ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your attention.
On behalf of the Assembly, I wish to thank the President of the Kyrgyz Republic for the statement just made, and I request the protocol to escort His Excellency. The Assembly will hear an address by His Excellency Kasym Jomart Tokayev, President of the Republic of Kazakhstan. I request the protocol to escort His Excellency. On behalf of the General Assembly, I have the honor to welcome His Excellency Kasym Jomart Tokayev, President of the Republic of Kazakhstan, and to invite him to address the Assembly.
Mr. President, Mr. Secretary General, Excellencies, first of all, I congratulate Mr. Qureshi on his election as President of the 77th session of the General Assembly. We meet here at UN headquarters at a critical time for humanity. The world of today appears to have entered a new, increasingly bitter period of geopolitical confrontation. The long-standing international system based on order and responsibility is giving way to a new, more chaotic and unpredictable one. The global system of checks and balances has failed to maintain peace and stability. The security architecture is eroding. Mutual distrust between global powers is dangerously deepening. The world is falling prey to a new set of military conflicts. For the first time in two generations, we face the prospect of the use of nuclear weapons, and not even as a last resort. New fault lines are creating artificial barriers and economic isolation. Economic and political sanctions have become a new norm which erodes the supply chains that ensure food security, threatening millions, especially in vulnerable communities. These problems contribute to the mounting challenges of soaring inflation, job losses, and fears of worldwide recession, especially for developing nations. And finally, these crises severely hamper the urgent action we all agreed to combat climate change and enhance sustainable development. Some 77 years ago, the founding members placed within the United Nations Charter the principles and the norms of international law that have successfully guided us ever since. There is nothing more important now than to return to the foundational principles that lie at the root of this universal organization. In particular, we must rethink the linkages between three primordial principles: the sovereign equality of states, the territorial integrity of states, and peaceful coexistence between states. These three principles are interdependent. To respect one is to respect the other two. To undermine one is to undermine the other two. When the global disarmament regime, both conventional and nuclear, weakens, these three principles are threatened. Conversely, as these three principles are respected, they grow in strength. Together, they become the basis for greater interstate cooperation at every level, sub-regional, regional, and global. This is the global prosperity dividend. This system of values embodied in the United Nations remains a beacon of hope for millions of people in different parts of our planet. We must staunchly defend these values, the United Nations as its core, and the spirit of cooperation which underpins it. In other words, we cannot simply shrug our shoulders and agree with polarization and division. We cannot afford indecision on narrow interests or detrimental to this common heritage and our collective good. Too much is at stake. Therefore, Kazakhstan stands ready to cooperate with all relevant actors in a spirit of inclusiveness, multilateralism, and goodwill. I am convinced that the challenges of our time can only be overcome by countries acting together. To achieve our shared goals, we must go forward in the following directions. The multiple and often interconnected crises of recent years have exposed significant gaps in global governance. They have highlighted the need to modernize and reform the United Nations. The UN must be better prepared for future challenges and opportunities. In this respect, Kazakhstan welcomed the proposals in the report of the Secretary General entitled Our Common Agenda. This is an important opportunity to reaffirm the Charter of the United Nations, reinvigorate multilateralism, boost implementation of existing commitments, agree on concrete solutions to new challenges, and restore trust among member states. We look forward to contributing to the consultations at the ministerial meeting next year and to the holding of the 2024 Summit of the Future. We must move from simply responding to global challenges and crises to preventing and better predicting emerging trends and integrating our assessments into strategic planning and policymaking. For this very purpose, Kazakhstan proposed 30 years ago the idea of convening the Conference on Interaction and Confidence-Building Measures in Asia. In the context of new challenges and threats, we hope to transform SICA into a full-fledged international organization at the upcoming summit in October in Astana to contribute to global mediation and peacemaking. With only 8 years until 2030, the Sustainable Development Goals are hampered by the COVID-19 pandemic, a triple planetary crisis, it means climate change, biodiversity loss and pollution, and conflicts around the world. We need to get back on track before it's too late. Our top priority must be build resilience to future turmoil and ensure sustainable, equitable, and inclusive recovery. To this end, we need a frank dialogue between East and West and a new global security paradigm based on the principles of mutual trust and multifaceted cooperation. Given the current crisis and increased geopolitical tensions, there is an acute need for a process under the United Nations auspices that can lead to détente and conflict prevention. Kazakhstan has suffered terribly from past nuclear weapons testing, so we understand very clearly the dangers of escalating tensions between nuclear powers. For this reason, nuclear disarmament has become a key part of Kazakh foreign policy, and we will be continuously struggling for a world free of nuclear arsenals. Despite some progress in this area, unfortunately, the whole record is not that positive. We are alarmed by the increased rivalry and rhetoric of nuclear states. We are also concerned at the lack of progress made by the NPT review conferences. Elaborating new mechanisms to ensure disarmament and non-proliferation is a daunting task ahead. Similarly, the COVID-19 pandemic has highlighted the urgent need to manage and reduce biological risks and dangers. It should be of universal concern that we still rely on the Biological Weapons Convention, now 50 years old, without any effort to create an agency or body for international cooperation. In this context, I would like to reiterate my earlier proposal to establish an international agency for biological safety, along with threats to international security. Climate change requires greater international cooperation and solidarity as well. Around the world, people are facing existential threats from weather and environmental change. If we are to turn this tide, we need more action, and we need it fast. Many of us have taken bold steps already. In Kazakhstan, we have pledged the total transformation of the oil and coal-dependent energy sector into a net zero economy by 2060. To save our planet, we need investment at greater levels than we have ever seen. However, climate action cannot come at the expense of development or modernization. Therefore, at COP27, later this year, member states, as well as the global business community, must once again scale up their commitment to greater climate finance. That agenda relates directly to the global food security crisis. My country, as the world's seventh largest grain producer, is the breadbasket of Central Asia. We are committed to utilizing this agricultural potential to fight global food insecurity. Kazakhstan will continue to act as a reliable supplier of grain and other food staples, first of all, to the poorest countries. It also intends to grow its cooperation with the Islamic Food Security Organization located in Kazakhstan, as well as other United Nations agencies. It's imperative in this connection to exclude food and fertilizers from any sanctions and restrictions whatsoever. Once again, current economic and social upheavals require a collective effort. Commitment to the 2030 agenda remains an integral part of our national and global agenda. In addition, fair trade regimes are crucial to global economic recovery. In this context, I would like to commend the constructive decisions coming out of the 12th WTO Ministerial Conference chaired by Kazakhstan. The current geopolitical situation also highlights the importance of a reliable and diversified global transit and transport infrastructure. We are seeing this in our own region. Kazakhstan, the largest landlocked developing country, is becoming a vital Asian land corridor to Europe. The Trans-Caspian International Transport Route, or Middle Corridor, has received a new impetus. We expect cargo volume through Kazakhstan to increase significantly in the years ahead. We must ensure that the Caspian Sea becomes a sea of peace and new opportunities. In the months ahead, Kazakhstan will help mitigate the most immediate impacts of limited access to energy and critical raw materials caused by trade and supply chain disruptions. In the long term, we aim to diversify our sources of energy with a particular focus on green hydrogen and renewables. Speaking about Central Asia, we should bear in mind that it has already become a region of vast opportunities for international cooperation. Together with our Central Asian partners, we are committed to strengthening political interaction and deepening economic ties to move our region forward. We agreed to coexist as good neighbors and diversify our cooperation. This credo is based on our significant natural and agricultural resources, human capital, transport and transit potential. We are a buffer market between East and West, south and north. We intend to work together with all stakeholders to address a pressing regional agenda that includes climate change, the Aral Sea, rational use of water resources, border delimitation, combating extremism, and expanding inter-regional trade. That's why we consider it important to establish the United Nations Regional Center for SDGs for Central Asia and Afghanistan in Almaty. Kazakhstan sees the future Afghanistan as a truly independent, neutral, united, prosperous state living in peace with its neighbors. Therefore, we support the difficult process of nation building in that country, including life-saving humanitarian assistance. Dear colleagues, as president of Kazakhstan, I am absolutely committed to build a just Kazakhstan, one in which every citizen has the same opportunities, rights, and protections. Justice in my country must prevail. Law and order will become pillars of our society. The most important part of this path is transformative political reform. Presidential and parliamentary elections will be held in Kazakhstan over the coming months. According to my proposal, the presidential mandate has been limited to 1 7-year term. It's a real breakthrough in developing democracy in Kazakhstan. At the same time, we will be firmly adhering to my formula of a strong president, authoritative parliament, accountable government. I am convinced this formula excellently serves the national interests of Kazakhstan. We also aim to demonopolize the economy. We are taking steps to ensure that the wealthiest in our society play their part in our quest for a just Kazakhstan, along with diversifying our economy and increasing investments in human capital. Recently, I initiated the creation of a national fund for children. Starting in 2024, 50% of the investment income from the National Welfare Fund will be allocated to special savings accounts for children until their adulthood. These funds could be used for education or housing purposes. A special private charity fund for the people of Kazakhstan also now provides assistance to ordinary citizens for healthcare, education, and social security aims. We aim to further expand the empowerment and participation of women in economic and public life. Comprehensive national transformation is not a simple process, and there will be certainly pitfalls and bumps in the road. But if we are firmly to meet the expectations of Kazakh citizens, we cannot deviate from this strategic path. Over the past 3 years, we have carried out substantial transformations through 4 packages of political reforms. For example, new laws passed by the Parliament simplified political parties' registration and reduced the threshold for parties to enter Parliament from 7% to 5%. To promote a wider involvement of citizens in governance, there is now a mandatory 30% quota for women and young people in electoral party lists. To make local administration more accountable, local mayors are now directly elected. To foster a more open culture between society and government, we have changed the law on peaceful assembly. Government authorization is no longer required. Following its international commitments on the fundamental right to life and human dignity, Kazakhstan abolished the death penalty. A just Kazakhstan depends on our multi-ethnic and multi-confessional solidarity. The unity in diversity principle will be preserved at all costs. Last week, the 7th Congress of Leaders of World and traditional religions was successfully held in Kazakhstan. The Congress once again highlighted the importance of religious tolerance, dialogue, and mediation. We are ready to build bridges and provide platforms for dialogue wherever needed. Dear friends, this year marks 30 years of Kazakhstan-United Nations partnership. The organization has contributed strongly to the formation and strengthening of independent Kazakhstan. Over that period, we have worked for the aims of the Charter in all major UN organs, from ECOSOC to the Human Rights Council and to the Security Council. Kazakhstan will remain at the forefront of advancing a more modern, efficient, transparent, and accountable organization. Never in history have we had such a need for responsible leadership for the next generations. Remembering our past makes us responsible for our future. Together with you, we'll spare no effort toward building a safer, more sustainable, and prosperous global community. Thank you.
On behalf of the Assembly, I wish to thank the President of the Republic of Kazakhstan for the statement just made and request the protocol to escort His Excellency. And before proceeding, may I just kindly remind delegations that the agreed time limits for the national interventions are 15 minutes, and you are kindly requested to adhere to this agreement. The Assembly will hear an address by His Highness Sheikh Tamim bin Hamad Al Thani, Emir of the State of Qatar. I request the protocol to escort His Highness. On behalf of the Assembly, I wish to thank, and on behalf of the General Assembly, I have the honor to welcome His Highness Sheikh Tamim bin Hamad Al Thani, Amir of State of Qatar, and invite him to address the Assembly.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. سعادة رئيس الجمعية العامة سعادة الأمين العام للأمم المتحدة السيدات والسادة يسرني بداية أن أهنئ سعادة السيد كاسافا كوروشي على توليه رئاسة الدورة 77 للجمعية العامة متمنيا له النجاح كما أعرب عن تقديرنا لسعادة السيد عبد الله شاهد رئيس الدورة 76 لما بذله من جهود ونثمن الجهود التي يبذلها سعادة السيد أنتوني غوتيريش الأمين العام للأمم المتحدة من أجل تعزيز دور الأمم المتحدة وتحقيق أهدافها. السيد الرئيس تحول عالمنا إلى قرية عالمية تتداخل فيها همومنا وتتشابك قضايانا ومع أن عالمنا تغير بوتيرة سريعة لناحية انتشار آثار أي حدث بيئي أو أزمة اقتصادية أو مواجهة عسكرية على المستوى العالمي إلا أن مقاربتنا وأساليبنا لم تتطور بالوتيرة ذاتها لتواكب هذه التغيرات الثورية وسواء كان الرأي أن العالم أحادي القطب أو متعدد الأقطاب فإن السياسة الدولية ما زالت تدار بمنطقة الدول المتفاوتة القدرات والمصالح والمصالح والأولويات وليس بمنطق العالم الواحد والإنسانية الواحدة وأقصد تحديدا إدارة الأزمات العالمية من منظور مصالح ضيقة قصيرة المدى وتهميش القانون الدولي وإدارة الاختلاف بموجب توازنات القوى وليس على أساس ميثاق الأمم المتحدة واحترام سيادة الدول كما أقصد عدم توفر آليات كافية للردع ومعاقبة المعتدين على سيادة الدول وعجز المجتمع الدولي
عن فرض التسويات حين يرفضها الطرف القوي في أي نزاع. في هذه الظروف تبرز أهمية الحكمة والعقلانية في سلوك القادة والتمسك بمبادئ العدالة والإنصاف في العلاقات بين الدول. السيد الرئيس، ندرك تماما تعقيدات الصراع بين روسيا وأوكرانيا والبعد الدولي له، ومع ذلك ندعو إلى وقف إطلاق النار ومباشرة السعي إلى حل سلمي للنزاع. فهذا ما سوف ينتهي إليه الأمر على كل حال مهما استمرت الحرب، ودوامها لن يغير هذه النتيجة، بل سوف يزيد من عدد الضحايا كما يضاعف أثارها الوخيمة على أوروبا وروسيا والاقتصاد العالمي عموما. وعلى صعيد آخر، لا أعتقد أن مندوبي الدول الحاضرين يحتاجون إلى التذكير بأن القضية الفلسطينية ما زالت دون حل، وأنه في ظل عدم تطبيق قرارات الشرعية الدولية ومع التغير المتواصل للواقع على الأرض، أصبح الاحتلال الاستيطاني يتخذ سياسة فرض الأمر الواقع، مما قد يغير قواعد الصراع وكذلك شكل التضامن العالمي مستقبلا. ومن هنا أجدد التأكيد على تضامننا الكامل مع الشعب الفلسطيني الشقيق في تطلعه للعدالة، كما أكرر التأكيد على ضرورة تحمل مجلس الأمن لمسؤوليته بإلزام إسرائيل بإنهاء احتلال الأراضي الفلسطينية وإقامة دولة فلسطينية على حدود عام 1967 وعاصمتها القدس الشرقية. وفي منطقتنا أيضا، عجز المجتمع الدولي عن محاسبة مجرمي الحرب في سوريا على ما ارتكبت أيديهم، وإمعانا في الخذلان أصبح البعض يسعى لطي صفحة مأساة الشعب السوري دون مقابل، ويتجاهل التضحيات الكبيرة التي قدمها هذا الشعب المنكوب دون حل يحقق تطلعاته ووحدة سوريا والسلم والاستقرار فيها. ولا يجوز أن تقبل الأمم المتحدة أن يتلخص المسار السياسي فيما يسمى اللجنة الدستورية تحت رعايتها. تقدم القضية السورية درسا مهما بشأن عواقب غياب الرؤية البعيدة المدى لدى قوى المجتمع الدولي الفاعلة حين يتعلق الأمر بمعالجة معاناة الشعوب من الطغيان اللامحدود والفقر المدقع والحروب الأهلية، أن تصبح ظواهر مرافقة لها مثل اللجوء هي المشكلة التي تحتاج إلى حل. نحن نقدر عاليا دور الدول التي استقبلت اللاجئين السوريين، ولكن لا يسعنا إلا أن نذكر أن علينا الالتفاف إلى جذور القضايا قبل أن تطرق أثارها أبواب بلادنا. وفي ليبيا نطالب باتخاذ إجراء دولي وفوري لاستكمال العملية السياسية والاتفاق على القاعدة الدستورية للانتخابات وتوحيد مؤسسات الدولة، والجمع والجميع بات يدرك أنه لا يمكن استعادة الدولة دون توحيد القوى العسكرية وإعادة تهيئة الفصائل المسلحة في جيش وطني واحد، ونبذ من يرفض هذا الحل ومحاسبته. وفي اليمن نرى بصيص أمل في توافق الأطراف على هدنة مؤقتة، ونتطلع إلى وقف شامل ودائم لإطلاق النار تمهيدا للتفاوض بين الأطراف اليمنية على أساس مخرجات الحوار الوطني والمبادرة الخليجية وقرارات مجلس الأمن ذات الصلة، وخاصة القرار 2216. إننا نأمل أن يتحقق التوافق الوطني في كل من العراق ولبنان والسودان من خلال ارتقاء النخب السياسية إلى مستوى المهام المطلوبة والمعروفة اللازمة، ليكون ممكناً تحقيق تطلعات المواطنين والتي تضمن وحدة الشعب والوطن وتحفظ تنوعه في الوقت ذاته. ليس الأمر ممكناً فحسب، بل هو واقعي للغاية لو توفرت الإرادة والاستعداد لتغليب التنازلات للتوصل إلى تسويات والتخلي عن نهج المحاصصة الحزبية الطائفية التي ترفضها الأجيال الشابة.
is abandoned. As this approach is السيد الرئيس نحن في قطر نؤمن بضرورة التوصل إلى اتفاق عادل حول البرنامج النووي الإيراني يأخذ بالاعتبار مخاوف الأطراف كافة ويضمن خلو المنطقة من السلاح النووي وحق الشعب الإيراني في الاستفادة من الطاقة النووية للأغراض السلمية ليس لدى أحد بديلا عن مثل هذا الاتفاق وسوف يكون التوصل إليه في صالح أمن واستقرار المنطقة وسيفتح الباب لحوار أوسع على مستوى الأمن الإقليمي أما في أفغانستان فإننا ندعو جميع الأطراف إلى الحفاظ على مكتسبات اتفاق الدوحة للسلام والبناء عليه ومنها ألا تكون أفغانستان ملاذاً للأفراد والجماعات الإرهابية والمتطرفة حتى يحظى الشعب الأفغاني بالاستقرار والازدهار الذي طال انتظاره
The Afghani people would enjoy the long-awaited prosperity and stability. We have stressed time and again the importance of protecting civilians in Afghanistan and respecting human rights, including women's rights and the right of girls to education and achieving national reconciliation among all segments of Afghani society. We also warned against the isolation of Afghanistan as this can be counterproductive.
الحضور الكرام بسبب الافتقار إلى التنسيق العالمي والتخطيط الرشيد والمتوازن للسياسات المتعلقة بالطاقة على مدى عقود عديدة فإننا جميعا نواجه اليوم أزمة طاقة غير مسبوقة إذ يعيش ما يقرب من مليار شخص في العالم دون مصدر أساسي موثوق به بالطاقة ربما كانت أزمة الحرب في أوكرانيا جديدة ولكن الأوضاع التي تتحول فيها الأزمات السياسية إلى أزمة طاقة ليست جديدة فقد كانت تتفاقم بصمت حتى قبل الحرب في أوكرانيا لقد تسببت في نقص إمدادات الطاقة عقود من الضغط لوقف استثمارات الطاقة الفورية قبل توفير البدائل المستدامة والصديقة للبيئة التي يجب أن نسعى إلى تطويرها ولا شك أن التغير المناخي وحماية البيئة عموما يفرضان علينا تنويع مصادر الطاقة في أسرع وقت لكن علينا أن نوفر الطاقة في هذه الأثناء وأن ندرك بواقعية أن مستقبل الطاقة مزيجا متنوعا من مصادرها المستدامة مثل الطاقة الشمسية والهيدروجين وطاقة الرياح والمصادر الهيدروكربونية
wind energy and also hydrocarbons.
وبفضل استثمار قطر في الغاز الطبيعي المسال منذ عقود الخلف تمكننا الآن من الشروع في توسعة حقل غاز الشمال والذي سيلعب دورا محوريا في التخفيف من أزمة نقص إمدادات الطاقة في أجزاء مهمة في العالم ثمة سلع مثل الطاقة والغذاء والدواء تحمل مصدريها مسؤولية تتجاوز المسؤولية التجارية وذلك بدءا بالموثوقية واحترام العهود ومن ناحية أخرى لا يجوز حظر مرور مثل هذه السلع أو منع تصديرها أو استيرادها في مراحل الأزمات السياسية وفرض الحصار على الدول
وبالدرجة ذاتها لا يجوز استخدامها أداة في النزاعات
حيث هي ليست سلاحا تماما مثل ما لا يجوز التحكم بمصادر المياه كأنها أدوات سياسية
To use السيد الرئيس, water sources as if they were political tools. Mr. President, maybe the situation of the world today paints a very bleak picture of the future of humanity, but we believe in dialogue and joint action.
بأن يحاول أن يضع نفسه في مكانه ليرى الأمور من منظوره
understand each other, putting ourselves in each other's shoes to see things from the other's perspective. Medium-sized and small countries are most in need of rules that govern international relations. Relying on major powers should not be a reason to abandon communication among each other. We all have a role to play. What appears today to be impossible
إذا توفرت الرؤية والإرادة والنوايا الحسنة.
إن النهج الذي اتخذناه في قطر هو التركيز على التنمية الوطنية والتنمية الإنسانية الداخلية وعلى السياسة الخارجية القائمة على الموازنة بين المصالح والمبادئ والوساطة في حل النزاعات بالطرق السلمية وإدراك مسؤوليتنا كمصدر للطاقة وهو ما مكننا من ترسيخ سمعتنا كشريك موثوق به دولياً. وسوف ترحب قطر بالعالم في نوفمبر من هذا العام عندما نستضيف بطولة كأس العالم. لقد تطلب التحدي الذي يقدمنا عليه منذ 12 عاما تصميما وعزما حقيقيين والكثير من التخطيط والعمل الجاد. وها نحن اليوم نقف على اعتاب استضافة منتخبات العالم وجماهيرها. ونفتح أبوابنا لهم جميعا دون تمييز ليستمتعوا بكرة القدم وأجواء البطولة المفعمة بالحماس وليشهدوا النهضة الاقتصادية والحضارية في بلادنا. في هذه البطولة التي تقام لأول مرة في دولة عربية ومسلمة ولأول مرة في الشرق الأوسط عموما سيرى العالم أن إحدى الدول الصغيرة والمتوسطة قادرة على استضافة أحداث عالمية بنجاح استثنائي كما أنها قادرة على أن تقدم فضاء مريحا للتنوع والتفاعل البناء بين الشعوب ونحن نلاحظ مؤشرات أثر الإيجابي لهذا الحدث في منطقتنا فقد قامت دول عربية شقيقة باعتبار بطاقة هيئة التي تشمل تأشيرة الدخول إلى قطر تأشيرة للدخول إلى تلك الدول أيضا ما قوبل بترحيب الرأي العام وحفز الشعوب العربية على التطلع إلى مستقبل Welcomed by the public as well, and it has also incentivized Arab nations to look forward to a future where there are no barriers among the peoples. The Qatari people will open its arms to welcome football fans from all around the world. I quote the Holy Quran, we created you as races and tribes so that you can get to know each other. Regardless of our different religions, our different ideologies, our duty is to overcome these barriers, to extend the hand of friends, to build friendship, to build...
I have the honor to welcome His Excellency Yoon Suk-yeol, President of the Republic of Korea, and to invite him to address the Assembly.
Mr. President,
Mr. Secretary-General, distinguished delegates, I offer my sincere congratulations to His Excellency Mr. Choba Kuroshi. Assuming the presidency of the UN General Assembly, I hope that the 77th session of the UNGA under your leadership will bring together the wisdom of each member state so as to shape a better world. I also express my deepest respect to Mr. Secretary-General Antonio Guterres for his tireless devotion as he embarks upon his second term. Under the United Nations Charter, we are called upon to endeavor to promote social progress and better standards of life in larger freedom.